I'm sandwiched between two giants, Will Sasso and Brendan Schaub. Sandwiched between two giants, Will
And one piece is gluten-free and one is not.
One piece is gluten-free, one is not.
And you can guess which one.
You look like a dirty, dusty Oreo.
I'm a dirty, dusty Oreo. They got a piece of old meat between two breads.
You're smushed between two Oreo sandwich smushing you together, and there's just cream around on the plate where it sits because there's nothing in between because it got smushed between the two pieces of Oreo, and one's very sugary and fatty, and the other's very gluten-y free. It's a very long lyric.
Very long lyric.
Right.
It is funny how I'm just 170 pounds between just a whole bunch of male meat.
Will Sasso in the house. The man, the fighter, the man, and the kid.
Hey, what show's better than the fighter and the kid? It's the man, the fighter, and the kid.
I don't like that song.
No?
I don't like that song at all. I don't like that song
What
at
else
all.
Rhymes with beat, beat, beat? It's fucking man, the fighter, and the kid. One is the man, and the other is the fighter, and then there's the other guy.
And right? There's the kid.
The other guy. No. Old as shit.
No, guys.
Old as shit. Oreo center, and he's dusty and dirty, and sugary on a plate, and he's smushed between two big pieces of black cookie, and that's how we do the man the final key.
You got a couple black cookies, a couple black cookies. That's one racist, to my left, bro. And one to my right.
Please, someone just isolate the part where Bryan says you are a couple of black cookies, and then put other guests in the show who happen to be black, so we will frame Bryan's being a racist piece of shit on his own show, and he'll get fired and replaced by the man, and that'll be the fighter and the man, and that's a show. Oh no, wait.
If I died, I was thinking about this. Would you come to Brendan and be like, dude, so sad?
I would go to him.
I know. You're like, you guys want to do fighter and the man? And you'd have like an effigy of me. What would you put in my place if I died? Like a blow up doll?
I think for a while.
Or a piece of muscle.
Like a piece of your muscle? Like rob your grave? Like get drunk? Hey, like the way they used to, like. Who passed away? There was like John Barrymore or something, and his actor friends took him for one last drink.
Yeah, well, I did that.
That's a bad idea.
I did that.
It's creepy as shit.
But they did it. Like
they really did it.
Oh yeah, these guys. Like I can't remember if it was John Barrymore who had passed away, or it was John Barrymore's friend and John Barrymore and other actor buddies, like guys of that era, and they stole their friend from the morgue, and then they took him out for drinks. I think that's what we should do.
Bill Cosby does that for days.
Yeah. Well, I did when my dog died of 11 years. My girlfriend who became my wife at the time started crying so hard, and I remember I wanted to go out with my buddies, and my dog died. I got a call from my buddy Andrew. He goes, Bryan, he was watching my dog. He goes, Piggy stopped breathing last night, and I remember my I got this like this feeling. I was like, ooh, my heart started beating fast because you know I love that dog, but I wasn't gonna cry. Mm-hmm. And I tell my girl, and she starts crying. She just starts crying, right? Because she's a human being and she has a heart. I'm dead behind the eyes.
Right.
So I've always had to detach. Growing up, I'd be living in like a country. We'd get a dog, and then my father would be like, guess what? We're going to Saudi Arabia.
You'd have to leave it?
I'd have to leave my dog behind.
You'd eat him.
Dude, I grew up like breaking attachments quickly, right? Not good for
that
a kid.
That explains a lot.
I'd say bye to two dogs, three dogs that I really loved. Yeah, that's
How
really
about when your son was being born and we were at the hospital and me, Dove Davidoff, and our good friend Sarah Rue, and you were like, let's go get something to eat.
Yeah.
As the kid was coming.
I don't deal well with
Right after Finn was born, he was like, let's go get something to eat.
I don't
See
do
ya.
Well. I don't do well with high stakes emotions, I guess.
Why?
Because I think as a kid, I had to cut them off very quickly. Like when you have to say bye to your dog as a kid.
That is tough.
Like I had to do that three times.
You know what?
That
but you know what
hard.
The interesting thing about that is though, Bryan? Here's what I'd like to say.
I'm opening up on this.
All right,
on
cool.
Their show.
But here's what I'd like to say.
I want to tell a story.
If you, okay.
Go ahead. What were you going to say?
Well, I was just going to say real quick that if you did leave us early, and that will not happen because actually, let's be straight up, you'll outlive me by like 25
I'm
years.
And me.
Well,
you don't see many old big guys.
Yeah. Oh, that's for damn sure. Speaking of. And
I'm going to sing at both your funerals.
No, well, I'll tell you right now, I'm gonna be the first like big 100-year-old.
I don't know, Will. I'm gonna be the first
big 100-year-old.
There's no reason for me to believe that. Like,
well,
there's no data for me.
All right, well, let's check in. Let's check in when, and you're gonna be around. So let's check in when you're 109
yep.
or 108.
And
you're 8 years older. So you'll be 100.
108, and I'll pass at like 100 and a day. But I'll tell you this, if you did, now this is the hypothetical, the show should be rebranded as Weekend at Bryan's, and we just prop you up Weekend at Bernie's
just,
style.
Dad, just, yeah. Oh, no.
Yeah, and just flap his hand and make him wave at the...
Put on a Tommy Bahama shirt and sunglasses.
we'll do all the episodes from a boat.
Yeah. And I'm not
from
wearing...
Marina Del Rey.
Yeah.
I'm not wearing pants, and my nails and my hair keep growing.
Oh,
really creepy. Oh, man. By the way, so the story I was going to tell was that when my dog dies, and we get home, and there's my dog literally on my picnic table. Andrew had been very nice and laid it out on a towel outside. Whoa. And Piggy was dead. And it's weird to see your dog that you've had for so long dead. And she was such a great dog. And Amanda's crying, and I go... And I was like, well, I can't bury the dog because the playoffs are on and I have to watch these games. So I'll bury the dog tomorrow.
Well,
and my friend's
serial killer.
Yeah, bury my dog tomorrow at my friend's property in Topanga Canyon. So I say to my girl, I go, honey, we'll bury the dog tomorrow. She goes, I want to bury it now. I go, I know, but we probably should wait because the sun's coming down. I'm making up any excuse so I can watch the playoffs. And also I have to mask my emotions. So then I go into the garage. She goes, well, what are we going to do with it? I go, why don't we just put it in a suitcase? I'm being really sensitive. She goes, okay. And I go in and I come back out.
Say horrible things, but in a soft voice.
I know.
You can't use a trash bag, huh?
No, she wouldn't let me do that. So I go, there's which suitcase should I use? Should I use the Bill Blass or the whatever, or the Samsonite?
Grab the Louis Vuitton,
Brian. And she goes, because I think the Bill Blass was more expensive. And she goes, I don't care. Just do it. And she's crying. And so I go and I get the Bill Blass one. I go, I think this one's more expensive and that should make you feel a little better. I put my dog's stiff corpse in the suitcase.
Stiff? Rigor mortis had set in at this point?
Yeah, because it's been 12 hours.
Quick.
Or whatever. It would been 12 hours.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
So I zip up the suitcase. I put it in my garage and there's my dog. And so it's very sad. I make plans to bury her tomorrow. So now... I go out with my buddy Gavin, with Anthony. You know Anthony Tambakis, both of you. Mm-hmm. And a couple other guys. And we start drinking. And we start toasting Piggy. And the next thing you know, we decide we're going to say bye to Piggy. Oh,
take boy. Piggy for a walk.
We're going to go take Piggy for a walk.
Just drag her on the ground. Just
come on.
We're
come on.
We're drunk. And we're like, woo! So my one buddy's not drunk, drives us back to my place. We're like, Biggie, and we break into my garage, and I take the dog, and I pick that suitcase, and we unzip, and we're like, Biggie, and I'm about to pick it out, and my wife, my girlfriend at the time, comes out, and you just hear her go, don't you touch my dog.
Oh, my goodness.
And in the middle of our drunken raving, we all went, huh? She goes, get out of here. Yeah, and she goes and zips the dog up, and very dignified, brings the dog, and puts it back in the garage, and shoot us the
you
fuck
guys are psychos.
Away. That's I know. Insane.
Here's one for you, Will. If Brian, or all you guys, if one of us dies, what song are we going to sing at the funeral?
Ooh, man.
There's one. Because real quick, 100%, my body's been through some shit, including my brain, everybody.
Yeah.
All right. So I'll be the first one dead for sure.
No, that's, well, only because 100%. I'm going to live to 100.
You're going to live to 100. Brian's going to live to 110. I'm going to live to, 90. What am I, 32 now? About 34. About 34. I'll be out. About 34.
I don't know what
I'm saying. How many big athletes have you seen with tats?
With tats?
With tats.
What does that have to do with it?
Well, you just don't, that kind of lifestyle. Like,
yeah, but nobody had tats.
A full sleeve comes with a lifestyle.
Yeah, but Rosie Greer didn't have tats when he played in the NFL.
He lived hard, he had tats, and he was big. His heart couldn't keep up with all that muscle meat.
You'd improvise a song at Brendan's funeral?
Dude, can't I get a legit song? At yours, I sing, oh, Dreamweaver. Do you like that one?
I like Skylar Astin's song he wrote for my father, and I could add some stuff to it. I played you
that. And you just put my name into it?
Yeah. What? Oh, my God.
It's a Taken. It's Taken. What'd you do, Will?
What would I sing for you?
Anyone.
I would
Brian.
Say, you remember when Princess Di passed away and then Elton John re-recorded Goodbye Norma Jean?
Ooh.
And he's like, goodbye England's rose, you read a bread about a dude. That's what I would do. And I would sing it as Elton John.
Although I never knew you at all.
Yeah. Goodbye, Big Brown. You had lots of tats in you. You did. You say you got hit in the head and you did a podcast called Fighter and the Kid.
But when you walked into a room, a smile would creep upon her faces.
Hey, wait a second.
And then I just jump out. I'm like, hold on, everybody. I'm
not dead.
I'm alive. You were so big.
Goodbye, Big Brown. You used to be the hybrid until the last of the fight on the kids. Change your name to Big Brown, and that's where you remain.
That's where you remain.
Came out of the woodwork. There's Brian Callen sitting next to you.
You're not such a big body. But your penis
now,
wait, was
listen
not
to Brian. Now listen to Brian do Katie Lang. Go ahead, Brian.
Go ahead, man.
It just sounded kind of like
with Will Sasso.
Constant craving.
It just sounded like kind of Katie,
Katie Lang.
Anytime Brian tries to do a singing impersonation, it just sounds like
dude,
Katie
good,
Lang
with, Elton John.
With a cold. All right, goodbye, let's hear your Elton John.
Goodbye, Norm. Goodbye, Big Brown. Oh, yeah. I never knew you at all.
Yeah.
You had the strength to hold yourself. Well, those around you crawl.
Roar. Yep.
Good. Crawled out of the woodwork.
Rear out of woodwork.
And they whispered.
Too many consonants.
Into that brain.
Brown is down. Now he's a big brown. And we got Piggy in a suitcase. Well, Brian's wife said, get away from the dog and get back in the house. You guys can drink, do all you want, but zip the dog up.
By the way, I hope I wonder how many people have turned this podcast off already.
None of them. They probably love it. Right. Now the office is around.
I would have liked to fought you, but you punched me in the back of the neck just to show how much it hurt.
I would have liked to have fucked you. Is that what he said?
Fought you, for fuck's sake.
I would have liked to.
No. It's my funeral.
I would have liked to fuck you.
But I would have liked to fuck you.
I find out you guys are gay. Yeah. I never told anyone this. But I wanted to suck your dick this entire time.
Whiz.
You were the cutest big man I ever seen. All those tattoos. And that that hair was such a sheen.
Remember when we used to wrestle? I used to go home and jack off.
You would hold me down against my will.
Yeah. And I would get real hard and jizz just a little bit in my underwear.
I would put you in my guard, and my rump would purr.
Yeah. I put my hand down there to see if it was just a little bit of flop sweat in between my thigh and my bum hole, but it wasn't. It was cum.
We are 10 years old.
Yeah, this is.
Really? Listen, man,
we're really off to the races.
I insist that we raise the level.
This really escalated.
Yeah, goodbye, big bro.
Let's record that anyway.
I wonder if I have a question. So you guys are my friends. And yes. You wouldn't judge me, right?
No.
Never.
No.
And I wonder if...
That's why we're friends.
Yes.
I was accused of something last night, this morning.
Can I guess?
What?
You're a liar.
I was accused of lying. I've briefed you a little bit on this.
I could have guessed this before you even told me, though.
I want to just see if you guys think this is a lie. I'm going to read you... Okay, so last night, I was working on Kingdom.
Yep.
And I ended up... I was on my way home. My buddy Frank Grillo, who's the star of the show, said, "Come eat with me." And I was starving. And I figured my wife would be asleep by the time I got home. So I kind of turned the car around and I went and ate. Now,
that's a lie. Yeah. Why are you lying to the listeners? Well, this can't be a proper litmus if you're going to lie in drum rolling something that may be a lie or not. Because then I'm just going to assume everything you've said thus far and to the end of this recording is a fucking lie.
Are you going to lie?
So why don't you just tee up that story again? And this time, don't bullshit us on the story about whether or not you're bullshitting.
No. Let's rewind. All right, let's restart.
Okay. The whole "I figured she'd be asleep" is a lie.
Well, no, because she goes to sleep early because she wakes up way earlier because she has to make breakfast for the kids and all that. So,
I
get a call. I'm heading sort of. Yeah, I'm
you
sort
know what,
of,
Brendan? Let's look the other way.
I'm sort of heading home.
Sort of. What the fuck is going on
you
here,
had no,
Brian?
You had no. You were not headed home.
All right.
You can't.
All right.
You were on set. Frank said, "Let's grab dinner." He said, "Let's
yes,
do it."
Yes. You said absolutely.
I don't know. I don't remember all.
I don't
those
remember.
Details, all right. I don't remember all these details. But anyway, I'm driving in the car, and I don't want her. I don't want to say to my wife, "Hey, I'm going to have dinner with Frank," because I don't want to hurt her feelings. I don't want her to think I'm not going to come home to her. But I do want to hang out with my boy, catch up, and eat a meal. I'm starving. I've been working all day.
Nothing wrong with that.
I should have said to her, "I'm going to go have a meal with Frank," but I didn't want, and
that's
she's
too
awesome.
Easy.
She's
that's
awesome.
Too
she'd
easy
go,
for Brian.
She'd go, yeah, she'd go, no problem, but I don't want her to feel a little bit bad because I should be home with my girl. So this is what I say. She calls me. I get a call and I'm driving in the car. And I know if I answer, she's going to hear that I'm in the car, which means I'm done. So I hit the pre, you know how you send a message and it says, I send her, "Sorry, I can't talk right now."
Why would you send that?
What the fuck? Why would you
send
that?
Because I'm an idiot.
So "Sorry, I can't talk right now."
Who uses those?
So she goes, "Okay, how's it going?" I go, "Good." Now I get to Cafe Stella. Guess what? Her friend is there. Oh, her friend goes, hey, your husband just walked in.
Oh, my goodness.
So now she writes, how much longer do you think you'll be on set for?
She's so smart.
Ooh, she already knew so much smarter than
you. Oh, but she's the best. And I go, I'm not sure because they jumped to another scene because of the stunts, which is true.
Sticking yourself
deeper.
Hold
on, it's true, but not now. That's why I was there so late. I should have been done by 6.
And that means it's not true. Yeah. Go on.
Yeah. Okay. Even though it happened, if it didn't happen then, that would be that a lie. That makes about as much.
Yeah, it just happened an hour before. So if you, by that logic, said, hey, honey, I don't know, Piggy just died, that would be true because Piggy died a decade ago.
So but now she knows I'm a piece of shit. And she goes like this. Are you having to sit around and do nothing since they jump scenes?
Oh, she's so awesome.
And I write cocky. I go, yup, with about 4 different 5 Ys. Yup. Right? So she goes, oh, man, are you able to listen to a podcast or something? I don't answer. And then she goes, that's so annoying. Do you have a trailer, you poor thing?
Oh, my goodness.
I go, yeah, I do. She goes, that's a relief. Now she knows I'm at Cafe Stella. She goes, is there decent food? I go, I don't answer.
Oh my goodness.
And I go, then at 10, I go, almost done. And then at 12, I go, heading home this morning.
Two hours later, heading home.
Dude, this morning. And by the way, but to my credit, I did take a picture of the menu. And I always do that. I go, yeah, I'm working. And I send her the picture of the menu. I go, I write, and she goes, oh, you scumbag.
All right.
Guess what? No, when I took the picture, Frank Grillo goes, dude, if you don't get off your phone, I'm going to kick your ass. So I go, oh, shit, okay. And I forgot to send it.
Well, hold on.
I did send her the picture this morning, so she sees that I actually did take the picture. So I do have the picture.
You kind of redeemed yourself there.
But
still lies.
Still in the doghouse. She just sent me this thread because I asked her to, but I'm in the doghouse.
Well,
now, was that a lie, though?
100%.
I think I'm actually more, I think I'm a little more shocked that you can't just take a screenshot of the conversation yourself because you were the other half of it. But that's me being pissed off at you not understanding.
I erased it by accident.
Yeah, but then I get super upset that you don't understand technology. And that's
very frustrating.
Yeah, you should for sure understand how to do that. But do you know how to take a screenshot on your phone?
I do.
I don't think you do. That's a lie. So now let's talk about you lying.
I hit this and this. I hit this.
That's right, Brendan. Correct. Hey, by the way, I don't want to digress because I want to get into this. But how come you're not getting iMessages, but you're on your phone?
Oh, because I had iMessage turned off by accident, and I just turned it on.
Okay. That's another super annoying thing. Brian has had iMessage off. So I'm like, did he go and get another Samsung?
I thought he had a Samsung because I kept sending the green text.
Green.
That's why I get green. I couldn't figure it out.
Yeah, it's really annoying.
My bad.
So
same thing happened on my phone.
It's back on.
As far as lies go, I think we have to attach. I think it should be a new segment for your show, called the Brian Callen Liometer, and it goes from 1 to 10, and on a scale of the Brian Callen Liometer,
this
is like a 2. This doesn't really move the needle.
Okay, what do you lie about, Will?
What do I lie about?
Maybe besides your sexuality.
Caught out of the woodwork with your dick hard in the butt.
Have you ever been just caught in a lie?
Where of course.
Where you just say something and you're like, why am I saying this? And
then I just go, run off. I tried to scream the person out of the room.
You just hurricane hippo.
You go, what was that? I go, and then if
did
they
you say
can
hurricane hippo?
Yeah.
Hurricane hippo.
The old hurricane hippo on him.
Yeah.
Hurricane hippo?
Yeah.
Sometimes I lie.
Oh, no.
Sometimes.
Oh, no, Will.
Sometimes I lie about being happy.
Will.
Well, that's not a lie.
No, I know. I'm just joking about that.
Shit, Will.
I don't know why my voice is doing that. I think I had a jalapeno.
It sounds like you're about to cry, bro.
No,
it sounds like you're about to break down.
No,
bud.
I was having a breakfast scramble and the jalapeno went. No. No.
Buddy, are you
I'm happy.
Oh,
no. You seem great, man. You seem like you're doing well.
Thanks, Brent. I don't know what's going on with my voice.
You have a huge lump in your throat.
I'm just going to tilt my head back.
So the tears don't fall out. Why do people do that? I'm trying not to cry.
Yeah.
Oh, I hate that.
Right?
The worst is when you are going to cry and you just, I had to give a speech. You know where I cry? I cry at weddings. I cried at my sister's wedding.
Sure.
I had to make a speech. And I started crying.
At weddings?
Dude, I don't know
You
why.
Know they're getting divorced?
No,
it was my sister's
the odds are they're going to get divorced, 53%. Oh. I think it's higher now.
Dude.
I cry at funerals. Last time I...
Not me. I'm
about
funerals.
To get... Well, I cry like a baby at funerals. Last time I cried was at when I lost Travis Brown. My coaches saw me in a ball crying on the ground.
Yeah, well, that's understandable.
Well, it's just because I knew I was never going to be a champ, so
why would you...
When you realize that at that certain point...
Damn, what do you say to a guy? Like, what would I say to
you? No one said anything.
No, you can't
literally,
say anything.
Literally, no one said a single word.
This is what you don't want to hear. Watch. You're crying?
Oh, why? Because I'm breaking tables?
Dude, You'll get it back. You'll beat him next time.
Yeah, you don't want to hear that while you're crying.
That's the worst.
I'll tell you what used to get me. You kind of reminded me of this because it's like, well, what do you say? What do you do? And with regard to, now I'm going to go from Brendan, a world-class athlete in the UFC, to peewee soccer. my buddy Phil, who was also the quarterback, and I was the center growing up, like all through football and high school, center and quarterback. He was the goalie in soccer, and I was the center halfback. But we were like, we were buddies. We were like the same size and same everything. We were all into the same things. He's still one of my best friends. And Phil, one time we lost, we got to the playoffs or whatever, we were like 10 years old, and we lost 6-0, okay? So Phil took it upon himself. And so we're sitting there, and we had this great coach. What was his name? John something.
Doesn't matter
at all for the story.
We don't know the guy.
Don't need to trim that.
John Stevenson. Keep going.
Hey, John O'Neill. Coach O'Neill. See? So we're standing around, and Phil gets choked because John's giving like a nice, well, you boys tried, rah, rah, rah. Okay, so Phil starts crying. And I'm like, you know, looking there. I am selling my buddy Phil out 30 years later. And all I had to do was put a hand on his shoulder to think, and there's some sort of weird like ET symbiosis that happens. As soon as I put my hand on his shoulder, I start crying.
Oh my God.
You did.
I start crying.
He didn't start crying harder?
He was crying. He may have. I don't know. I was in my own thing at that point. I was like, now cut to 6 or 7 years later, we're in high school. And we get knocked out of the playoffs, right? He's a quarterback on the center. We're the captains of the football team. And we go down and, you know, he's sitting there on the bench afterwards, I think. And he's, he didn't want anyone to, you don't want to see the quarterback.
Hell
right?
no.
But kids, you know, getting knocked out of the playoffs. You know, here we are getting knocked out of the playoffs again. He's got a towel over his head. And I go over and I'm like, hey, Phil, hey, I'll get him next time. And I put my hand on his shoulder. But then I realize.
It triggers.
Right, but I realize that he's crying as I put my hand on his shoulder. So then I'm like. But we're both like, we're not 10 anymore, you know. We can't
we're
let.
Not 10.
Right. We can't let the team see the captains of the football team.
Hell
like,
no.
And that's how I cry. I cry like Popeye.
I've only seen my father cry once, and that's pretty heavy if you ever see your father, like your hero.
I've seen once.
And when my father's mother died, I remember we were in the car, and he got the call that she stopped breathing. And I heard his breathing changed a little, but he held it together. He goes, well, when did she pass?
Oh, man.
And he goes, I saw his breathing. He went, okay. Your grandmother died.
Oh,
and
my goodness.
And we were driving, and it's such a father-son moment because my father's an Irish Marine. There was no emotion. Emotions were always considered to be kind of a, you know, something you keep under wraps. And we're watching a football game, and all he said is I was sitting kind of in front of him in a small chair. He's in the bigger chair, and he goes, and he said, I wonder, we were talking about his mother, and he said, I wonder when you actually die. What is the mechanism in the brain or the body you're finally like, so if your heart stops, you still have brain activity.
Yeah, for sure.
When is the moment that you die? Like, how do they consider that? And he asked that question. And the next thing I know, I hear him. I see him go. I hear his breathing change. And he's got his hand. He grabs his forehead and he's crying into his hand. Like, he's just looking down. He's got one big hand covering his eyes. Oy. He's crying. And I don't know what to do. So I just reached back. And I put my hand on his knee.
Yeah, there you go.
And all I could do.
How old were you?
I was probably 20, 21. Okay. And I had my hand on his knee, and he was crying. It was two dudes, and he cried, and then he stopped. And all I said is, I go, it's kind of a blow, huh? And he goes, nah. And that was it.
Gee whiz.
It was fucking the only time tough, I ever, man. He's tough as shit.
Big I'll cry Callen. Over. If I see someone else crying that I know or care about, I'll start crying.
Yeah.
Yeah. You got to meet Phil.
You're a
I want to see
dude.
If he'd cry.
You're very sensitive.
Big time.
We should introduce Brendan to Phil and just see if he'll cry. If Phil cries, but we got to make Phil cry. And Phil's happily married.
Here's my question.
You know,
why do we cry Like, I can't really isolate why we cry when something glorious happens. Like, so when my sister graduated from college, this guy who was blind graduated. He graduated from Northwestern, one of the hardest business schools in the world, blind.
Yeah, sure.
And he turned, as the graduation, I noticed everybody was like clapping and going crazy. And he turned to the audience and just looked out, but he couldn't see. And everybody went crazy.
Dude,
I started crying so hard. But why was I crying? What is it about that? I even get emotional talking about it now. But why? Like, why does that? It doesn't make me sad, but it makes me profoundly joyous.
It's called joy, you sociopath. You just saved yourself.
Yourself.
But why do we cry over that? It's interesting.
It's called emotion.
But plus, you didn't know him.
Right,
you didn't know him. Have you seen those 30 for 30s on ESPN?
Oh my God! Like the Gotti Ward thing.
Gotti Ward, or
Bill Lampley crying. I was crying. So
well,
hard.
Yeah, that's a completely different show, but I feel you there.
that's very nice.
That's HBO, but I'm talking about 30 for 30.
Yeah, sorry.
But no, any of those sports things where you can see it and they face adversity and just get through it. This is my thing, though, with that whole ESPN Author Ash Award, for courage. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a basketball. I know we talked about it two episodes ago, but there's a girl who had cancer. Listen to this. This is who deserves the award, not Caitlyn Jenner. Fucking educate yourselves. This girl.
Bob Costas
was
over here.
Was diagnosed with cancer. She had 1 year to live. All she wanted to do is finish her final season of high school basketball.
Damn.
Wow.
That's it. She played her entire senior season. Like, they just put her in. She could barely function. They put her in, but she'd get through it. And she was going to die. As soon as the season's over, she died.
Doesn't she retire?
She their last game, she goes and she scores a bucket. They score a bucket. They pick her up, take her off the court. Oh, the girl died. You know what I'm saying?
I feel like crying now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that kind of
and
stuff.
And that was not even much of a 30 for 30 delivery, and I still want to cry.
Yeah, so
I think that kind of thing, I think the reason we cry in moments like that are so glorious is it's such an overwhelming number of feelings that you don't even know what to do with them. Like, I think it might be just a tidal wave of all the different emotions, like the tragedy, the triumph, all that. And then it's kind of, I wonder if it's just your brain gets so short-wired on how to process it all that you just end up
But
crying.
I think you can relate to it. You're like, God, what if that was my mom? What if that was my sister?
That's true, too.
You know what I'm saying? So you put yourself in there. Well, it's like in my the community I live in, it's a gay community, and the guys that work at the front, the security guards, you see them every day, so you become friends with them. My favorite security guard, we'll call him Mr. O'Neill. Mr. O'Neill.
John O'Neill, my soccer coach?
Yeah. Your soccer coach works at my PD now.
Yeah.
Very
so
every day I would see him. He's my favorite. And usually I just go by him. I wave and I go by, right? Well, every time I see him, I talk to him because he's had a rough life. He's a good, great guy. Just super outgoing. I feel like he could be doing something else with his skills.
Yeah.
So I always try and relate to him, help him however I can. So he's been gone for 3 or 4 weeks. I'm like, what the fuck? Finally, I see him. I'm like, my man, what's up? I can tell he's not the same. Like, he's a little down. I'm like, what's up, man? He's like, you've realized I was gone, huh? No one else realized it. I was like,
wow.
Of course I realized it. You're my favorite guy here. And he goes, yeah, man, just some personal problems. And I was like, oh, you don't have to get into it, man. He's like, no, I haven't been able to tell anyone because they told me not to, but I'll tell you. He goes, I commute from Marina Del Rey, where you live. I live in South Central. I take the bus to get here. And he goes, and my girlfriend was sick. He said my lady, so I don't know if it's wife or girlfriend. He goes, my lady was sick. I went to the store to get her food or medicine, and I got kind of gang crossfire. He goes, I got shot in the shoulder and in the back.
Damn.
And I go,
wow.
What the fuck?
Fuck, man.
I'm like, what? I'm like, how does this happen? He goes, just knuckleheads, man, just egos, and I got caught in the crossfire.
Damn.
He goes, it's the second time in a year he's been shot from crossfire.
How about that? And I wonder.
And then I went, oh my God. And right away I went, what can I do, man?
What can I do?
And then I was talking to Joe. I'm like, what can I do for him? I have to do something for him.
She's like, "What are you gonna do?" Even you said this. You're like, "What are you gonna do? You gonna move him to somewhere else? Like,
change
what
the
do you
fabric
do?
Of that society that he's living in?"
So I know he likes frappuccinos. I got him a Starbucks gift card.
That's the funniest part of the story.
That's what I did.
I know.
I was like, "Hey, man, I what do you do? What do you give him?
Here's some
grand?
Caffeine and some milk and sugar.
Here's a gold chain for sure. You can get shot with this in South Central,
right?"
Yeah. And then I was like, "Well, I know he likes shoes. I was like, I'm gonna buy him some new Jordans." Wrong move, Big Brown, because he wears those Jordans to South Central.
Right.
He's going to get in trouble.
God, that's
right. What the
it.
Fuck do you do?
That's the hardest thing.
So I knew he loves frappuccinos. I was like, "Hey, hopefully you get better, man. Here's $50 at Starbucks.
You gotta
all get the frappuccinos you can though. Handle.
Yeah, you got to get him a pair of green New Balance. You can't get him red
nerdy,
or blue Jordans.
Nerdy yeah. shit. Yeah.
I don't know, man.
Here's a pair of skinny jeans.
That's right. The hardest thing about life is that is realizing that there are problems and good people are facing them and you can't do a goddamn thing.
You're talking about a great guy.
I can't stand it. That drives me crazy. That you can't do anything really to help people.
What do you do?
I don't know what the fuck you do.
I think so long as you stay happy.
Oh, God.
Oh, he's back.
Oh, God.
Will's happy.
And then that's what you got to push forward and live the joy.
You
live
know,
the joy.
You know, people do find, it's funny how in through the biggest shit, I'll talk about a story that made me cry. They had this like Holocaust survivor and she was saying her sister and her were forced to work in the fields and they were starving and it was in Germany. And it was her sister's birthday and she found a fucking blueberry, and wrapped it in a leaf and gave it to her sister. And her sister said, and then she died, but her sister lived. And she said, "That blueberry in a leaf was the greatest gift I ever got."
Oh,
she
my
said,
goodness.
She said,
Jesus, Brian.
I know. I'd like to bring the whole place down. But holy shit. I was crying. I was like.
we're just one-upping each other on sad stories.
A woman who died 60 years ago and wrapped a blueberry in a leaf. And I was crying so fucking hard. That's glorious. That's kind of like, I think that, again, that's triumph over, fuck you guys, you're not going to keep me down. Even a blueberry is my way of saying I'm still a human being.
Now, did you split the blueberry?
That's
so you both live?
That's hard to
do. Could you took a chunk and then shared
it
with your sister?
She ended up being,
it's kind of like Titanic. Killed. Could you have taken turns on the door?
Yeah. Oh, and there was more than enough room for two on the door.
Yeah, that was a giant door.
Yeah. How big a blueberry was it?
Could you have switched? Is it like one of those weird process berries?
No, it was
huge.
It was probably a little tiny. It was probably a little tiny concentration camp blueberry.
You're going to have to share.
You don't get a lot of nutrition.
You're going to have to share, bro.
I know.
That is an unbelievably sad story.
There's so many stories like that. There's so many stories of humanity in shit.
Yeah, you should tell them until the end of this podcast so that everyone gets thoroughly bummed out.
Yeah, hey, man, you look like you have no energy left in your arms.
Whatever, man.
Whatever, bro.
I'm here for you, dude.
Well, look at. Did you have something you wanted to share with us? I feel like
I don't have anything.
Not anymore. Not anymore. Man.
I took all the wind out of you. I can't even hear what you're saying.
You know, here's the thing about that is I was just kind of thinking of myself.
You got to speak up, man.
Well, no, I know. We're doing a podcast. So the thing to me, when I think about, you know, life and the joy.
When's the last time you cried?
Oh.
Because you're a big, fat fucking baby.
Last night.
Oh, last night before bed. Every night.
Awkward.
Yeah. I just I say my prayers and then I
what do you say?
I do my
what
mantra.
Do you pray to?
I do my mantra after that.
Have you ever cried? You're so happy,
huh?
Have you ever cried? You've been so happy. Really?
Yeah.
Like you got a huge role or something? You started crying?
Yeah.
Really?
When
I got.
I've never done that.
It's because you don't care about anything. But
no, usually it's when I'm in bed, you know, and I sing my little song at night.
What song do you sing at night?
I say that. I go like this. I go.
Take it easy.
When I was young, I never needed anyone.
Keep going.
Making love was just for fun.
You got this, guy.
Those days are gone. All by myself.
God,
it's
so good.
Ooh, it's nice. Do wanna be. Oh, my,
you got some snot.
Snot bubbles.
Did I get it?
A huge snot bubble.
A huge snot bubble comes out like a baboon's wonk and goes back in. Oh, man. Hey, you guys, I've been listening to the show, man. You guys have been doing all sorts of interesting stuff on the show. What was one of the things you guys had and you were interviewing about? All sorts of interesting things. You guys had Hulk Hogan on recently, right?
Yeah.
Evan, why don't you play some of that interview? And that was the end of that story, brother.
Okay. Yeah.
Wow. Hulk Hogan. Yeah.
Yeah, brother.
So, Hulk, what have you been doing?
Oh, well, let me tell you something, dude. I've been training. I've been saying my prayers. I've been eating my vitamins, brother.
Okay, now, let me
but you're
you.
Old
you
as shit,
prayer,
Hulk.
When you say your prayers, who do you pray to, Hulk?
Well, I pray to God up on high, brother. That's God. That's the Father from the Mother riding on the back of that red and yellow Harley, brother. Riding on the front, dude. He's on that angelic platinum chrome Harley, brother, with the white detail, dude.
Hulk,
and that's,
who
I pray to, brother.
Now, can I ask you a serious question? The
yeah,
sex
brother.
Tape.
Yeah,
what
brother.
Do you think of that?
Wow, that was an incredible interview you guys had with Hulk. And it's interesting, Brian and Brendan, yeah. You guys were interviewing him about the same thing, faith and prayer. And I just thought it would be cool for Evan to play some of that interview.
That was good.
So that was pretty cool that you guys
they
played
cut it off
Evan,
right before
Evan,
we
do you have any,
the sex
do you have
tape.
Any? Do you have any more of that interview?
Do you have the sex tape
play
part?
Play a little more. No,
play the sex tape
play
part.
Play a little
now.
More of the interview. What?
Yeah, yeah, I'll cue it up right now.
Yeah, okay.
Play
here's
the sex
more,
tape.
Here's some more of the interview. And that's how I slammed that Andre the Giant right down through the mat at WrestleMania 3 in front of 93,173 screaming Hulkamaniacs, brother.
Now I gotta ask you, your son Nick, how's he doing?
This is a that was so cool that you guys had Hulk.
Now, it's weird because Hulk drives me fucking nuts.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
he never gets into anything personal.
No, but
yeah,
Evan won't really play doesn't. The whole thing. Evan won't
Ev,
play.
You gotta
thing.
Play.
Well,
when
trying to
play
to keep
personal.
Just keeps trying to keep the show going.
Yeah, he's
think,
trying to keep
so.
The show going.
Really
so he
is.
Keeps cutting back to us.
But
so let's
I think
go.
He does mention some stuff. To
it's like
yeah,
stuff.
He mentioned some real
let's
life
see if we can
stuff.
Get to some
it's like he won't
stuff.
Shut the fuck up, but old school wrestling.
Yeah.
You know,
really tried to dig deep.
Find a part where he talks about real stuff.
That's what we specialize.
All right, yeah,
that's what we specialize.
Go to the part where he talks personal.
All right, try this part.
Yeah, brother. And then I was playing the bass when I was in high school, brother. I thought I'd be a rock and roll dude, brother. But then I met up with Fuji Nakamura, the guy who trained me, brother.
Wasn't that around the time when there was a big steroid scandal and you guys were all doing steroids, or at least accused of doing steroids?
Well.
Were you ever tested, Hulk?
Hold on a second, brother. You got to remember, dude. Back then, I was playing bass, brother, because...
That was pretty cool that you guys had Hulk on.
Yeah, I know.
It's like
really
Hulk
cool.
just will not dive into
he
the stuff we want.
Yeah,
I feel like he just goes around our answers.
Well, he no. does. He tends to circumvent any real question, and that's
I just think it's cool that you guys had Hulk here. I wish I was here. Well, Hulk was
he's
here.
Your favorite.
Thanks, Evan, for playing all those
yeah.
questions.
Yeah,
yeah,
that was
yeah he's
great.
One of
that
my
was
favorite.
Good. It's good to have the you know guys like him being big fans of the show.
What else is going on with you dudes, you know?
I want to apologize to you, Will, for not mentioning the 10-minute podcast.
Oh,
enough.
What's that, Brian? Go ahead.
I want to apologize to you for not mentioning the 10-minute podcast enough on this podcast.
That's fine. You don't have to do that.
We do some funny stuff.
Will, can we
that's...
talk about the 10-minute podcast live being number one on iTunes
in
the comedy section?
Well, you know, we can do all of that because I got a little surprise for you guys now, and it's this. And nope, I don't. wait, hold on.
Come on, bro.
What I meant to say was this.
You're better than this.
Hold on.
What? What's the problem?
You're kind of playing our theme song. It's not very orthodox.
Welcome to the 10-Minute Podcast. If you're going to buy something on Amazon, please go to 10minutepodcast.com, hit the Amazon banner. You'll get your stuff at the same price, and we'll keep this show going because that's what we want to do. Our recent live show is out on iTunes. You can go to 10minutepodcast.com, follow the banners there, the yellow one, and then you get that font. Please rate and review the 10-Minute Podcast on iTunes and tell all your friends about it. Name today is Will the Man Sasso.
I'm Brian the Kid Callen.
Yep.
And I'm Brendan Big Brown Shop. I'm glad to be on the 10-minute podcast.
Because
you guys have never had me on.
No.
I feel like I always reach out to you guys,
and
you never have me on.
Right.
Hey, Chris D'Elia.
Yeah.
Beat it, nerd.
We're going to get into a few of those topics today because I'm sitting here recording what I like to call the man, the fighter, and the kid because I'm over here in Marina Del Rey at the Fox Studios with Brian and Brendan, and I've decided to hijack your fucking podcast for 10 minutes and record a 10-minute podcast.
Taken style.
You can't just come in here.
You're like Liam Neeson.
I mean, I'm part of this podcast, the 10-minute podcast.
Yeah.
And I appreciate that, but you can't just come in without my permission.
Why not? Why can't I just record a 10-minute podcast?
It's a little unorthodox.
Well, I'll tell you. Let me tell you what's a little unorthodox, Brian. A little unorthodox is getting constant tweets to our Twitter, which is at 10minpod. Please follow at TENMINPOD.
Yeah.
And people saying, "Hey, Brian was talking about. Hey, D'Elia was on the show, and you guys didn't talk about the 10-minute podcast. Or Brian was over on, you know, whatever this podcast or that podcast. That's saying, hey, talk about your podcast, and doesn't come close to bringing up D'Elia.
D'Elia was on here. Brian's on. You got two out of the three from the 10-minute podcast.
Right.
They didn't even mention.
No,
they didn't have to mention it, Will.
Did you?
Yeah.
And that's funny because when Brian and Chris are with me on what I like to call my podcast, 10-minute podcast, we talk about the fighter and the kid all the time. So here we are. We're in your fiefdom. We're in your court.
Yeah.
And, you know, Brian, you're a guest today on 10-minute podcast.
Right. Yeah. Well,
so what would you like to say to your listeners?
Look, all right. First of all, I apologize for not – we get caught up in conversation. I should be mentioning the 10-minute podcast.
No, you don't have to mention the 10-minute podcast. I'm very happy for what's happening here with the fighter and the kid.
What would you like to do in this 10 minutes? I mean, we're already running out of
time. We've got about 7 minutes left.
Well, so let's do something.
7 minutes.
Let's do a 10-minute podcast on the fighter and the kid.
Let's do it.
Yeah, let's do a 10-minute –
This is – I can't believe we're doing a podcast within the podcast. It's kind of crazy, but
– No, it's podcastception.
Chris D'Elia, Big Brown's cutting in. On the 10-minute podcast.
Well, that's another thing. We've been trying to get – here's the thing. We've been trying to get Brendan to come record at the house and do 10-minute podcast, but I kind of feel like you're definitely the liaison there.
Yeah.
And you haven't
invited
him.
No one's ever asked me, ever.
Now, hold on. I didn't
Now, how long have you been doing Fighter and the Kid?
About three years.
That's ample time to say, why don't you come by?
It probably is ample
time. Now, Brian,
time.
I appreciate you, as we say on the 10-minute podcast, because you live, where the fuck are you, in Simi Valley?
You know the answer. And you guys know the answer. I'm in Calabasas, so
you're in
please
Ohio.
Be respectful of where
and
I live.
I love where you live, and I love your home, and I love your family, and I love the fact that you can come out and still do the 10-minute podcast 3.5 years into doing the 10-minute podcast.
I got some new characters.
You're still out
too.
There. No, we don't want to do that now, for sure.
But I save that for the actual.
I do have some new characters.
But okay. I save that for the actual 10
minutes. Yeah, maybe save that for the actual 10-minute show. But then you got to come all the way out here to Marina. So I don't want anybody to think that I don't appreciate what you do. I really do. I just and it's all good. I just felt it would be fun for me to come on and let your listeners know that you also have a mistress called the 10-minute podcast.
I do.
Yeah.
I do. And
your guys' show, I was there, and Brendan, I thought it was dope.
Yeah, thanks, buddy. Killed it. Are we still number one on...
I believe we're still number one on iTunes in the
I saw it.
Albums.
Yeah, I saw it.
That's kind of crazy.
But, you know, here's the thing.
We're beating out Kevin Hart and Jim Gaffigan, I believe.
Yeah, but their shit's been on there forever.
iTunes work is it's really who's current.
Like
most
recent.
Recent.
We'll be down to 150.
How much money will I make off this?
None if you don't start talking about the 10-minute podcast. But I tell you what, we are in the middle of Fighter and the Kid. I don't want to completely hijack the show. But
we got 5 minutes left, 10 minutes?
Yeah, about 5 minutes. So here's the thing. We're having a good time on Fighter and the Kid. If you're listening to this on 10-minute podcast, go over to Fighter and the Kid. And per the Fighter and the Kid, we should just keep going with Fighter and the
Kid. Keep going.
And per that, and I don't want to take over. I mean, it's your show.
You got this, man.
But one thing we were doing before, and which was a lot of fun, was, Evan, will you play a little more of that interview? Evan the Beard, please play a little more of the interview.
The Hulk Hogan
Brendan
on
and
Fighter
Brian
and the Kid?
With
play the part
Hulk
where he
Hogan.
Gets personal. We really want to get...
I need the sex video where he talks about Nick being a dumbass.
Well, maybe don't play the
cars.
Personal. Yeah, well, what do you have?
Let's
see.
Just play whatever you got.
Play whatever you got. And then WrestleMania 2, brother, I slammed that King Kong Bunny right down through the mat, brother.
Yeah, I remember.
And I climbed the cage,
much,
dude.
How much
and that's
this...
how and that's how I won. And that's how I won WrestleMania.
Now,
brother.
Now, would you say since you've tanned so much and you look like a hot dog that you're gonna die of skin cancer or no?
That's incredible that you guys had Hulk here. That's so amazing that you had
it's
Hulk.
So
here.
Weird.
It's
and
so
it's weird. We just cut off
Evan
every time
I
he gets
Evan
good.
I wish Evan would let this run a little bit more.
Evan,
because I really
the beard's driving
to,
me nuts.
I had some questions.
Play
I
a little more. Play some of the personal stuff.
Talk about where he does the Hogan hair slide while he's getting his dick sucked.
Well, let me tell you something, dude. I went over to WCW, brother. I went over to Ted Turner, dude. And then I started the NWO and all my NWOites, brother. They're for life, dude. And they know that we're too sweet. Me, Scott Hall, Kevin Nash, brother. And we changed the landscape, brother, of professional
didn't
wrestling.
You go, didn't
sports
you leave,
entertainment,
didn't you leave
dude.
Ed McMahon and you went over to Ted
Not
Turner's
Ed McMahon, brother. He was the sidekick
Vince
on
McMahon.
The Johnny Carson show, brother. And that's very important. If you're going to have a bit, dude, and the bit is that Evan the Beard's cutting to these interviews with Hulk Hogan, brother. But the thing about it, brother, is that when Will goes, hey, let's listen to more of that interview, and then he
just pretends to be Hulk Hogan, dude, then you can't say things like, hey, when you left Ed McMahon, brother, because here's the thing about that, Brian Callen. You know what I mean, dude? Because I'm like, does this guy know what he's talking about, brother? Because Ed McMahon does not own the WWE, brother. Ed McMahon was the sidekick on the Tonight
Show.
And
he's Lex McMahon's dad.
He's your manager's dad.
Yeah, brother. Dude. And he had the publishers clearing out sweepstakes, brother. He'd come to your door with that big check, brother.
Hey, is it true? Is it true Hulk Hogan and Razor Ramon ran a train on some girl?
I can't believe that you guys had Hulk here. And that he's such an amazing guest.
He's amazing, man.
Not that amazing because he's really not aware that he's being asked questions, and he just talks only about his past.
Look, he ignores
as
our questions.
They're real.
Yeah, we're here.
Does he believe they're real? Does he actually believe those fights were real? I mean, where he's very.
Does
aware.
He really think he can fight? You think, Will?
Do you have anything with about that?
Yeah, I asked him. I said if. You got in a legit fight, what would happen? You're on the street in Miami.
Roll that part.
Roll the part where I said who would win in a fight. You or Kimbo Slice, Hulk Hogan. Here's his answer.
Yeah, this is great.
Well, let me tell you something about Kimbo Slice, brother. He's my brother from another mother, dude. He's out there clanging and banging. Just like Hulk Hogan, brother. And just like Hulkamania will never die, dude.
I know,
Kimbo
Hulk,
madness
Hulk,
is running wild,
fight?
Brother.
But
even though he has a professional record Hulk. As a mixed martial artist of what? Brendan, how many fights did he win?
Not a lot.
Well, let me tell you something, dude. I'd drop that big leg on Kimbo Slice, brother. I'd slice him off a little something right down the middle, brother. And I'd smack that. I'd lay the smack down right on Kimbo Slice, brother.
How do you think
brother?
You'd do against someone like, my God, Brendan Schaub? As a fighter, I mean.
Well, let me tell you something about Brendan Schaub, brother. He's a fighter, but he's also my brother from another mother, from the other mother, brother.
The other side.
Yeah, brother.
We're both
tan
as shit.
Yeah, dude. Yeah. We're tan brothers out there in Marina Del Rey, brother. It doesn't matter if we're in Tampa Bay, brother. It doesn't matter if we're in Venice, California.
I know,
and that's my old gimmick, brother. Hulk Hogan from Venice Beach, California.
But Hulk,
303 pounds,
brother.
Do
you believe that you actually, you don't really believe that you could fight in the UFC, do you?
Unbelievable stuff that you got from
crazy.
Hulk here.
I know, it's so
I know,
cool.
But
now,
I
did
never
he kind of he kind of dodged the questions?
Yeah,
a little
he does.
Bit.
He's very good. He's like a politician.
Yeah, it's sort of like here's what I got to say about that. It sort of feels like he's a superhero, and we all need to respect him as a superhero. And
so you believe that he eats his vitamins, and that's why he's so large.
Well,
Will
Brendan, he trains, he says his prayers, and he eats his
and that's
vitamins.
That's why he's so huge and tan. Especially at this age.
I mean, Will, do you think...
You know what, through the interview off...
I'm a huge fan of his. Do you believe that he didn't do steroids?
Thank you so much for listening to the 10-minute podcast. We only have a little bit of time left.
Hey, Will, you know what
I want to say
the interview
that,
up?
Please, what did you say?
You know what messed the interview
What's
up?
What's that?
Is when the old kid here thought it was
Ed McMahon.
I feel like that threw the whole vibe.
Yeah, let's go back to... Well, you just sidestepped the question I asked you.
Well, we're almost out of time, Brian. We have like 15 seconds left on the 10-minute podcast.
I know, but
in 15 seconds, did he take steroids?
Did who take steroids?
Hulk Hogan.
Why don't you let Hulk Hogan answer that? Let's hear a little bit more Hulk.
Well, let me tell you something, brother. I slammed that Andre the Giant down, Papa Shango, King Kong Bundy, Randy the Macho Man Savage, Ultimate Warrior, brother. It didn't matter if I was up. Even my brother, Brutai.
You're not answering
Brutus
my
Beefcake.
Question.
Hulk Hogan,
wow,
how are you
unbelievable. Unbelievable.
Oh, man.
Unbelievable that you had him.
Yeah, well, that's the end of the 10-minute podcast,
Thanks
guys.
For letting me hijack your podcast.
Yeah, no, that was
it's
good.
It's my first 10-minute podcast.
Yeah.
You did a good job.
Although
really
I would like to come into the actual studio, 10-minute
Come on
studio.
By. We'll record
it's
a
tough.
Bunch of them.
It's tough. It's
I want
a small
sing,
space.
Though. I
no, it's not
sing.
A small space. It's
it looks
only
legit.
Half the size of this room.
That's
well,
true.
this table, I feel like we're at a middle school cafeteria at this table.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Will, you? I want to actually jump over to the fact that you spent a lot of time with Nick Cage. Nicolas Cage doing a movie.
Well, not a lot of
does
time.
He still buy
just shot movies.
Does he still buy castles and shit?
Does he still buy what?
He buys castles and shit.
I understand that he bought a haunted house in New Orleans. He was talking about that. The house is legitimately haunted.
Good guy?
Really actually a very sweet guy and a consummate professional as an actor. It was really, really cool to be around. Well,
super
I mean, he's
talented.
One of my favorite
actors.
Give
me an example. I love him, yeah.
Well, yeah, Nick Cage is like literally doesn't. He does not stop. I didn't. You don't see him... he doesn't flub a line. He charges through. He knows all his stuff. And if there's something he wants, with this film, there was an element of improvisation to it. And so, yeah, he would just charge through everything. And Larry Charles was directing, who of course did Curb Your Enthusiasm and was worked on Seinfeld and did Borat and Bruno and
dang.
The Dictator.
So is this a comedy?
He's a legend.
It's a comedy. Yeah, it's a comedy. It's a dark comedy. Here's what it is for those who are curious. Nicolas Cage is starring in a movie called Army of One about this real-life guy named Gary Faulkner who claims he went to Afghanistan and Pakistan 11 times to kill Osama bin Laden. This is a real dude. And you can Google it, and you can watch him on Letterman, and it's something else. So Larry Charles directing, there's like a lot of improv in it. Nicolas Cage plays Gary Faulkner, and then there's Russell Brand is in it. Your pal Wendy McClendon Covey is in it. Yep. Myself, awesome. Paul Scheer, whom I'm a fan of.
When will it come out, Will?
I don't know.
And by the way, this guy who actually went to kill Osama bin Laden, do we have proof that he actually went to these countries, or we don't really know?
I kind of surmised from the fact that, well, Nicolas Cage and Larry Charles went to speak to the guy.
Right.
And I kind of surmised from some of the stuff we were talking about from that they don't think he went.
Was the guy a military guy at all? Or was
no.
He was just a
bullshitter. He's crazy, yeah.
But I love that you can bullshit get a movie made.
I play one of his friends back home in Denver.
Yeah.
Did you shoot at all in Denver? No, we were in, he's a Denver guy. Yeah, you got to look him up. No, we shot it in Vancouver, where I'm from.
You told me that Nick said something pretty interesting about your life versus work, and you can be crazy in your work, but you don't want to be crazy in your life.
Oh, yeah. Well, I guess
you
want to
share that personal story on the
air? Yeah, yeah. Why don't I share that? Well, now
I'm personal?
No, it's not that personal. No, we were just talking about, just life and work and stuff. And yeah, I don't like sharing what people say in private conversations.
I don't know
but
if that's that personal.
Whatever, Brian. It wasn't that personal.
It's kind of an interesting thing to say.
That it's important to be very normal in your life so that you can be very off and here and there and up and down and tap into whatever you want to do
with
your work.
Risk. Is always saying like take risk with your work, because does this work or is this only work if you're an actor?
Well, I think he's speaking as
regular life.
I think he's speaking as an actor,
yeah.
Saying
no,
you can
really
get
into
all sorts of bizarre characters, scenarios.
But I think what's interesting is that every time you see, like, say Liam Neeson, my buddy is really good friends with him. He said he lives like a monk.
Why don't you share some personal stories?
He lives like a monk. He doesn't drink. He goes home and reads. Granted, he's 64, but a lot of it, makes a lot of money. And what happens is, if you want
to
keep something going, if you become very successful at whatever it is you do. The truth is, it takes so much energy and discipline. You got to wake up early. You got to be on point all the time. You have so many people you're responsible for. That the irony is, you may have $100 million in the bank, but it requires such an enormous amount of discipline in your personal life just to have the energy. So you can't be going out tearing your head up and chasing this and that. You've got to kind of, in a way, the more successful people become, and I've seen this a lot. They actually do become very self-restricted.
I think that's
with
everything,
habits.
But I think when you're young and successful, you can kind of teeter that line. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Because obviously there's a lot of musicians, actors, athletes who are very famous and very rich, and they're not going home getting their 10 hours of sleep. You know what I'm saying? They're going out, bottle service, girls, whatever, and then waking up.
Yeah,
going
it's not sustainable in LA.
It's not sustainable.
Not at all.
If you live like that in LA, you'll last 5 months.
I agree. 100%.
Well, because your call time is 5 a.m. and you're getting done at 8 or 9 or 10 or even
I agree.
Later.
Yeah,
I
agree.
You need to learn.
Oh,
that
real quick, it's called discipline. Yeah. I think that helps out in any
and in
whatever
Liam Neeson's case. In Liam Neeson's case, it's called a specific set of skills. Sorry, everybody.
No, can you do a Nick Cage impersonation after being with him?
Well, no.
Well, we have a little.
My Nicolas Cage is just from it's from Honeymoon in Vegas.
Which is what?
The Seven Pools Are Here. That's it. Or I did like a Vine as Nicolas Cage. I'll never show him that.
Yeah, for sure, don't show him.
No. But look. Hey, I like to goof around on things like podcasts and stuff. But then also, I'm a professional actor. And part of being a professional is
shut up,
you leave those conversations on the set.
Yeah,
you don't drag them onto your fucking podcast, like Brian Fuckface over here.
You should shut up.
The thing about that though is
I'm
gonna continue on through and let you know. You probably just don't even need to get into the whole fucking thing. Yeah, we made a movie. Good thing. Hey, you make movies. You do movies. All right, everybody.
Yeah, but shut up.
You don't want to blast out Nicolas Cage's personal.
It's all right.
It's not personal. It's not personal. No, there's nothing personal.
I heard he has a green tree boa.
What?
I heard he has a lot of weird things.
Yeah.
Awesome guy, though.
I love him. Is he in shape, by the way? Does he stay keeping
busy? All right, so anyway, what the fuck? Jesus Christ.
Anyways, with Nicolas Cage. Brian wants to know the size of his hands and feet.
Yeah.
He's a big
kid. It's weird. Hey, before we get into current events or creep line, I got one for you. Does he have a beard? Yeah. A big dick? Which I heard he does.
Liam Neeson,
I heard, is packing
13
out.
Inches.
I heard Liam Neeson's packing a fucking homer.
Here's what I heard. It's ready for this? It's off-putting.
Here's
that big.
Here's what I heard.
That
now, hold. Yeah, and I have it from a very good source.
Off-putting.
off-putting.
Really?
Off-putting.
Here's what I heard about.
You don't carry that swagger like that. I heard he can fight too. You know, you used to box.
Really?
I love that. Oh, yeah.
Here's what I heard about Liam Neeson's penis. I will find you, and I will fuck you. Sorry, everybody.
Where was that clip from?
That was from his movie Fucked.
Fucked.
Taken.
This is one word.
No, that's
movie
his movie.
Was that Fucked
Taken,
one
Taken.
Or two?
No, it's from Taken from Behind.
Heyo, heyo. There's your Ed McMahon. Heyo, yes.
And
yes, sir.
Liam Neeson in the movie Taken.
Hey, before we get into current events or creep line, I got one for you. How about the dudes who fucking Shawshank Redemption it broke out of prison? Have you seen this, Will?
Ooh. No, what?
Oh my God, these two dudes,
both
in prison for life for murder. Bad people.
Yeah.
Break out. They can't
really
find them.
They can't find them.
6 days now, gone. They think the
Z
they think one of yeah right they think
Andy
one of
Dufresne
the workers at the prison gave because they got out with power tools. As they escaped out the back, they left a note that said "Have a nice day" with a smiley face.
Whoa!
And they
can't
find them
now. Don't get me wrong. What they did, the murders are awful. I'm not supporting that. But them getting away is pretty cool.
I'll tell you. Yeah.
It's a set of a movie.
Well, no, but we have to suspend our disbelief to hope that they are actually wrongly accused of their crimes. And one who was wrongly accused and one who served his time and understands. And that would be the Morgan Freeman character. Of course, the former being the
Red.
Tim Robbins character.
You're talking
in
about
order
Red
so that
and
we
Andy
can
Dufresne.
Live out this. Yeah,
and are they
this,
on a beach somewhere in like.
Zwantenejo. Andy Dufresne is my friend. That's right.
How crazy is that, though? They can't find him. So they have helicopters everywhere. And they say both guys are very smart. Obviously, to set all this up, they timed it perfect time of the year.
Damn
so they
right,
can't track
I gotta,
snow.
I got to say, I agree with you. Of course, I don't support, you know, what they did to put them in jail and the slammer. But I'll tell you what, you kind of hope those guys got all the way to South America.
But you know what they're in prison for?
What?
They're really bad dudes. One killed a cop, shot him 12 times.
Oh, yeah.
The other murdered his boss and tortured him.
Okay, well then, here, let me all right,
tortured him, then snapped his neck.
Add an addendum to this then.
We don't support that at all.
Right.
I support the fact that it's kind of like a movie, Shawshank Redemption.
I want them,
it's cool to see the chase.
Here's what I want. I want them to, and this is the documentary, and then they'll make the film out of it. I want them to end up in Chile, as Brian Callen likes to call it.
Chile.
Or Paraguay.
Or Paraguay.
Uruguay. Or Argentina.
But what about Afghanistan?
Afghanistan, though, because there's not enough there. But you want them in South Africa, South America.
South
America.
So Osama bin Laden.
So we can say things like Chile and Santiago.
And then I want them to like open up like a restaurant or like this night spot, and they're like they're in with all the gangsters, and it looks like they've pulled it off.
They've had some plastic surgery.
They've had some plastic surgery, and then they just unceremoniously get shot by a sniper.
That'd be dope.
Like a SWAT sniper.
Me too.
Just pop, pop.
Sweet ending.
I think actually a better way is they just die
before anything cool happens.
Yeah,
I think it's
before they reap any benefits.
Like they don't even get to like get drunk or have sex.
No. They're like, oh my God, I'm about to fuck this girl. It's been so long.
Yeah, point.
I like them dying in a stupid way. Like one guy slips in the bathtub and hits his head and he's all fucked up for a while. And then a dog bites another guy and it gets infected and he just, he dies. He shit dies. He just dies in a shit way. Yeah,
That's what they deserve.
Yeah.
But how crazy.
Like just, we made it all this far and then a dumb dog went with its front teeth, a little dog, but his mouth was dirty.
Bacteria.
It gets infected. He's like, I'll be fine.
Leg
necrotis.
Off.
They have to cut his,
could they call the movie Shit Dyers?
Shit Diaries. The Shit Diaries. The Shit Diaries.
Hashtag Shit Diaries. How'd you die in that shit way? You go through all that and then just some shit.
But they're,
shit
they're saying they haven't seen him for 6 days, and these guys are either they think they're someone helping them, and they're already out of there.
I'm sure.
Like they're wasting their time. They're saying flying around because they would have found him by now.
Certain number of people die.
Taxpayers'
every
money,
year.
My man.
A certain number of people die every year by having soda machines fall on them. And
vending
that's a
machines.
Fact. Vending machines.
Not soda
and
machines.
And one guy
die.
I just want one guy to die having a vending machine just kind of fall on him.
It's pretty shitty, dude.
And he's like, oh, and he can't get out, and then nobody can hear him, and he just dies.
I might be that guy. I go to vending machines all the time.
I have news for you. I think you're strong enough to get a vending machine off yourself.
That's a good point.
You're like, hold. Yeah.
Good point.
Yeah, you could. I have a feeling you could bench a vending machine off.
I don't know how much they weigh. But what if I turn around and was like, Brian, look, peanut M&M's, boom, back in the neck.
then I'd be like, oh.
Brian, look, baby Ruth, I'm dead.
Oh, God. That's such a bummer. I got a baby. Yeah.
Anyways, hello, I'm Ed McMahon. Welcome to another episode of Shit Dyers. Today,
today
we're responsible way to die. Go.
Well, there's always torture. It's a never good thing.
So you're saying if ISIS caught you and tortured you?
Just some shithead. But forget torture, because that's obvious. So you have to think, what's the worst way to die? Well, if you were to die, I don't want to be trapped in a building when it crumbles.
Are you talking about September 11th style?
No, well, they died very quickly of fire.
No, they didn't, Brian. Whoa, they were up there. They couldn't go down because the fire. There's no way out. So instead of burning alive, they had to jump out of the window.
Well, that's not good.
That might be worst case scenario.
Well, no, it being doesn't trapped, beat that. Trapped under rubble for 3 days and then dying, that wouldn't be good.
Look, well, guys, they're all terrible.
This is Fighter the Kid Dark Edition.
Yeah. I know.
This dark is Fighter the Kid. We're super dark.
Yeah.
I'd like to be accepting a prestigious award and have a cartoon cat come up behind me, shove a stick of cartoon dynamite up my asshole, light it, and blow me up.
And then that's go, we take two steps forwards, you take one step back.
I'll tell you what's the scariest way for me to die after being in Costa Rica, having a crocodile.
I live healthy, and I like to smoke.
Yeah.
I like to keep it real, and I like to smoke.
Yeah, it was always
Paul Abdul and the cartoon
DJ Scat, MC Scat Cat. It was just the dumbest shit. Where
I take two steps forwards, you take one step back, and they're like in a tandem dancing, pushing each other in the street and shit.
Yeah, and who was the voice of the cat? It was the guy in the 40-year-old Virgin. Romany Malco is the voice of the cat, I believe.
Which one's that?
I don't
that
know why
old
I know
virgin?
That. He's the guy, the black guy, the bald guy.
Oh, really?
Is the voice of MC Scat Cat?
Oh,
I believe
sick.
When yeah. I like being healthy, but I like to smoke. I drive slow, but I drive fast. Who knew we'd get together? Cause opposites attract. Yeah. I like hot food and I like cold food. This song is boring. I think it's quite good. It's just like,
but it was
like,
a
I like
video.
The color black. Didn't I like the color red. Just all right. Anyway,
you have no idea what we're
talking
about.
Blanks there.
Hashtag old as shit.
All right.
Let's go to current events with Evan the Beard. You have a creep line, K? We'll do it after this.
Skipping right over Fight Talk. We got to make some picks.
You want to do Fight Talk right now?
Yeah, that's how it is. We do Fight Talk. We do current events. We do fan questions.
Let's
isn't it?
Do it. Right. Just give us the main ones.
Yeah, we're
this
just going to bang through
hey,
the,
real quick,
the
this
top
card,
three.
Not great. Especially for a pay-per-view, not great.
Yeah, the UFC New Orleans card wasn't great on paper either, and that was dope.
The UFC New Orleans wasn't bad.
It was pretty
UFC New
damn
Orleans better
good.
Card than this pay-per-view, by far.
It was pretty good.
It was great.
Anywho, let's just jump right into it. First fight that we'll talk about is Kelvin Gastelum, Nate Marquardt at 85.
Don't wait for my picks and piggyback on this. Go, Brian.
Well, let me tell you something, brother. Nate Marquardt, he's going to slam, what's his name, brother?
Kelvin Gastelum.
Right down through the mat, dude.
I like Hulk Hogan making the picks.
I'm going to go with Hulk. I don't bet against Hulk, and I love Nate, so I'm going with Nate.
Yeah, I'd never pick against Nate. Nate's one of my closest training partners of all time. He's like a brother to me. I haven't talked to him in a while, but it would be great to see Nate get a win. People got to remember, this is Nate's first time back with Trevor Whitman. They haven't worked together in years. When Nate was the Strikeforce champ, when Nate was when he fought Anderson Silva, Chael Sonnen, he was with Greg Jackson's camp and Trevor Whitman. He's back with Trevor Whitman. And for this camp, he also spent most of the time at AKA, which isn't too shabby either.
So what about Trevor Whitman? What does he bring to the table that, say, another coach doesn't?
I think Nate made a mistake leaving Leister Bowling, who was my head coach and his head coach, and he's the head wrestling coach over at Muscle Farm. So he left Leister and went to Trevor Whitman. If he was smart, he would have stayed with both. He would have made it somehow work. I don't know the dynamics of the team there right now because I'm not there, but right. He should have made that work. So I'm taking Nate. I don't know how he's going to get done. It's going to be a tough one. He's the underdog. He didn't look good his last fight. He's obviously on the back nine of his career. Somehow
he's been fighting since he was 17.
Somehow Nate's gonna get done. I don't know how, but I'm rooting for Nate. Again, if this is ESPN Big Brown breaking down the fights, I give you the legit picks that I really think is gonna happen. If it's the Fighter and the Kid, I pick who I want to win. Don't bet on my picks on the Fighter and the Kid. Don't give me shit.
It's all emotion. It's all driven by emotion, ladies and gentlemen.
I like Nate. I don't know Kelvin. There you go. So I pick Nate.
Got it.
Beat it, nerds.
Co-main event, Gilbert Melendez, Eddie Alvarez.
Ooh.
Brian? It's a great co-main event.
I do not bet against Gilbert Melendez, even though he got caught by Anthony Pettis. No shame there. I always go with Melendez. Eddie Alvarez is a bad motherfucker, but...
Real quick, everyone that we're going to talk about is a bad motherfucker.
And Eddie Alvarez is a winner, but I think Gilbert Melendez has just too much for him. I think he's going to beat him.
Yeah, I think Gilbert.
Good fight, though.
This is your fight of the night, 100%. Yes. And I take Gilbert Melendez. Eddie Alvarez has looked like shit since he came to the UFC. This always happens.
It's so interesting, right?
And I'm an Eddie fan.
When he fought Donald Cerrone.
I'm an Eddie fan. But these guys get all this hype outside the UFC, and they want to rank him pound for pound and all this shit because he's beating all these, you know, B-list, C-list fighters outside the UFC. When you get to the UFC, man, it's a different level.
You said something really interesting. You went after Eddie Alvarez, and there was all that hype, and he fought Donald Cerrone, and you said you get in the UFC, and you just look like another guy fighting. I mean,
yeah, man, these guys build up these great records, but when you get to the UFC, it's not. There's no cookie cutter fights. There's no ideal matchups.
Yeah, bro, it's the big time, dude. And that's why Bad News Alvarez is going to slam Stuttering John Melendez right through the mat, brother. And he should have never left the Howard Stern show, brother.
It's actually Gilbert Melendez.
Yeah, brother.
Very
what's eating Gilbert Grape? I'll tell you what, brother. Bad News Alvarez, dude.
Bad News Alvarez.
Yeah, he's going to put him in
Hulk Hogan making UFC picks. That's pretty cool.
It's going to be good night, Irene, for Stuttering John, brother.
I got Gilbert Melendez in a decision, but it's your fight of the night. It'll be back and forth, but I don't know who you're going to toss. You can't give Eddie easy fights. I don't know who you're going to toss Eddie to get a win in that division. Good luck.
Jesus.
All right, we'll go straight to the main event. Cain Velasquez, Fabricio Verdum, heavyweight title on the line.
You know who I'm picking.
And of course, go ahead and take the favorite.
Well, I don't know.
Take the favorite that everyone does.
That's right, brother. The favorite is the evil demon Cain, brother. He's got that mask. He's 7 feet tall. He's one half of the Brothers of Destruction with the Undertaker, dude.
Not that Cain.
Yeah,
Cain.
It's not
different.
Cain.
It's Cain Velasquez.
It's Cain, brother. He does a choke slam.
No.
Big goozle.
That Cain looks scarier, but he's not as tough. He's not as tough.
He doesn't have a red and black outfit, brother.
No, I wish he did. He'd be more marketable if he did.
But now he's corporate Cain, brother. He's got that suit and tie. He's working for the authority, brother. Triple H, Stephanie McMahon.
Wrong guy.
That's wrong
not,
guy.
Not Cain,
yeah,
brother.
We're talking about Cain Velasquez.
K-A-N-E, brother.
No, we're talking about
wrong,
Cain
wrong.
C-A-I-N.
Hulk, oh. You're off on this.
All right, brother.
Who you got, B?
I don't.
Stick with Cain. Go ahead. Give us why Cain's going to win.
Because he's just impossible. His pace is impossible to deal with.
Yep.
He puts his head in your chest.
Yep.
I think his hands are better than Fabricio's.
Yep.
And I just think he's going to wear him down.
He's also 7 feet tall and 300 pounds.
Now,
wrong guy, Hulk.
Oh, sorry, dude.
What do you think? I want to hear your take on this.
Well, you can see the legit breakdown on my Twitter, Instagram when I did on ESPN, the Big Brown Breakdown.
And you can see my boat on my Instagram, brother.
No, but we're not talking
Hulk,
about
we're not talking about you right now.
All right.
We're not talking
about
you. All right, brother.
All right, brother.
So all right, keep going, Brendan. God, damn it.
Yeah, so you can see the official Big Brown Breakdown in ESPN. They tweeted it.
You can get
it.
Links to Hogan's Beach on my Twitter, brother. You can come on by and have some chicken
Hogan,
strips,
Hogan, I'm about
brother.
To choke you out.
And a Bud
you
Light,
hot
dude.
Dog? I'm about to give you the Hogan hair slice.
Right,
take
brother.
It easy, Brendan. Take it easy. Take
all right,
it easy.
Dude.
Just please.
Hulk Hogan. I hate Hulk Hogan.
All right, dude.
Please let him finish.
Cain,
Brendan,
brother.
I like Andre the Giant better anyways.
Just keep it down. Keep it down. Don't insult him.
I think I don't know how Verdum's going to do it, but I think Verdum's going to get the win by submission.
You do?
Yeah, because Verdum's too smart. There's only one guy with KO power in that fight. There's only one guy who finishes fights in that fight. It's not Cain. Cain, when he fought Junior Dos Santos and he sets this crazy pace, Junior's not a very good grappler. Junior didn't use his footwork. He allowed him to be pushed against the cage and was just looking for this one-shot knockout power.
Well, you should be climbing up the cage to get out, brother, because
no,
those
no,
are the rules
can't do
of
that,
cage
Hulk.
Match.
You can't
sorry.
Do that.
I'm
damn
sorry,
it.
Brother.
It's not a cage match.
No, call,
there's no ladder. Right.
Damn it.
No blue cage?
No. Wrong.
Right, brother.
It's UFC.
So Verdum's fuck. Smarter. And you got to remember, Cain's had 600 days off. 602.
That's a lot of days off.
Called ring rust. At this
damn.
And not only is it ring rust, but you're fighting five rounds now. He's been hurt. Not only has he been hurt, but he's had surgery. So you're not back in the gym training. You're rehabbing just to get back to normal. You're never going to get back to normal. It doesn't work like that unless your name's Adrian Peterson and you're in the NFL. So
that's right. Adorable Adrian Adonis, brother. He
wrong guy, Hulk.
365.
Wrong guy.
Not
all about fucking.
All right, bro.
Fuck you, Hulk.
Sorry, dude.
No,
I thought you were talking about adorable.
Take
the
it
adorable
easy,
one.
It's like
take
the Hulk
it easy.
Just won't shut.
I know. It's okay. That's
it.
Well,
Brendan,
well,
you wanted to have him on.
I
know. I love the Hulk.
All right. I thought you were talking about. Adorable Adrian Adonis,
Hulk,
brother.
Please. I want to talk about the sex tape. You won't do it, and I won't shut up during the fight segment.
Sorry, brother.
All right.
Listen, Verdum isn't a guy you impress against the cage and just beat up. His jiu-jitsu is the best in the world. He can jump to half guard and do work from there. And you're batshit crazy if you don't think Verdum can submit Cain. We saw Verdum submit Fedor. And we're not talking about the Fedor Bigfoot fought or Hendo fought. We're talking about the Fedor that everyone was terrified of. He destroyed. this is going to be that similar fight. And I'm going to go out and say this. If Werdum were to beat Cain, he goes down one or two greatest heavyweights of all time. What? If he submits Cain. Ooh. Think about it. He's beat Fedor, destroyed Travis Brown, Roy Nelson. You know what I'm saying?
He's done whatever he wanted.
You think about it. Then you submit Cain Velasquez. Jeez, he's going to go. If he does this, which is a big if, and people give me heat. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm not taking the favorite and give you fucking cookie cutter answers. Here's
you would have been one of the best heavyweights of all time, brother. Up there with them super heavyweights, brother.
There's no super heavyweights.
Like Andre the Giant, dude. No. Haystacks Calhoun. No, the one-man gang, brother. Even on up to King Kong
Hulk,
Bundy, dude.
Hulk, St. John Studd, brother.
The Butcher, brother. Hulk. All the super heavyweights. Vader, dude. Vader. All the brother.
There's no Vader.
Big Van Vader, brother.
You're fucking... Brendan, hurry up, man, because he's...
All right, we'll just get over it. Hulk, just shut your yapper.
All right, bro. I thought you were talking about super heavyweights.
Yokozuna, dude.
No, I don't want to talk about Hulk. Yokozuna.
Yeah, brother. All the big super heavyweights, dude.
Fuck Yokozuna.
All right, brother.
Sorry, man.
Fuck.
The big boss man, brother.
So here's the easy route to go. Kane's going to put his head in his chest, and he sets a crazy pace, and he's going to wear out Werdum, and he'll win
that's
in a decision.
That's not how I talk, so that's
no,
a I'm shitty.
Not. No, this is everyone. This is everyone who doesn't know the complex of the UFC. Yeah. He's going to go down. He's just going to keep taking him down, beating him up against the cage. It's going to be a five-round decision for Kane. Yeah. But you say anything else like, oh, you're a hater. No, I'm not. I like my odds. I like Werdum. If I'm putting money on this fight, I'm putting money on Werdum.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah, dude.
You have that much respect for Verdum's jiu-jitsu is ridiculous.
That much respect?
It's
ridiculous,
right?
Oh, why? Because he finished Mark Hunt? Oh, why? Because he beat the fucking brakes off Travis Brown? Wasn't even a fight.
Yeah, brother.
It's true.
Yeah, dude.
Oh, because he destroyed Roy Nelson?
Yeah, yeah, brother.
Submitted Nogueira?
Yeah, dude.
Stop doing that.
Submitted Fedor?
Yeah, brother.
But don't put your hand on my face when you say that.
Submitted Fedor?
No, don't touch my fucking mask.
Submitted Fedor?
Don't put your...
Yeah, brother.
Nogueira, Fedor, Gonzaga.
Let me tell you something
Travis Brown, fucking Roy Nelson. Think about the Cain. He beats Cain.
Then that's a big deal.
Big deal.
It'd be tough to get by that choke slam.
And we need him. We need him as the champ. There's no choke slam.
No, I'm sorry,
choke
brother.
Choke slam, man.
I'm going to choke
confused,
slam your ass.
Brother. I'm
this
confused.
Ain't that WWE. That, yeah.
All right, brother.
I'm going to choke slam you, Hulk.
Well, maybe it's a WWE.
Let's get Hulk out of here. Hulk. All right.
Hulk, beat
hey,
it, nerd.
Thanks. All right, brother.
Thanks for
hey, well, let me tell you something, brother.
No, beat it, Hulk.
Evan, shut his mic off. Shut his mic off.
Fuck you, Hulk.
Fighter as shit, dude. Thanks, bro.
Yeah, see you later.
Jesus oh, Christ. My God. Hulk's driving me nuts.
Will, why didn't you say something to the fucking guy?
He's my hero.
Will,
I
that,
know,
that's
but you
got a friend.
Like, yeah, he's you bring hero. Him in here.
I thought he was really good at analyzing the fight.
Well, no, he wasn't. You know, everything that guy does, you think is good. You got to, and you
I
know,
think he broke
you love him
the fight
too much.
You on. Don't bring him. He's
I don't care who's facing Kane. If Kane gets a choke slam, that's the end of that.
You know, man. All right.
You don't think so?
You're just off,
Will.
All right.
It's the MMA. Yeah.
Well.
It's frustrating, Will.
Well, I can be up and down and crazy in my work. A wise man once told me, so long as my life is normal.
All right. Well, that's what I said, and that's what Nick Cage said. Evan, let's move on. Thank you for breaking down that fight.
Get up here, Key. It's time for a little bit of creep line.
Ooh.
Creep line.
Creep
we got a nice line. Creep line illustration that our boy at Frontline Customs sent
us.
Check out at Frontline on Instagram. Our boy just sent that to us from New York, along with some other wonderful paintings. We got a Kurt Cobain painting, straight from his documentary cover. And we got a, who is that over there in the Porsche? Who is that, Brian?
That's James Dean, my friend.
James Dean. That's right before he died in his Porsche.
Who I said was because actually decapitated in his car, but I guess he wasn't. I guess he was
no,
teenagers.
Yeah, you made that up.
That's I heard lie. That a lot.
Yeah, I didn't, though.
No?
No, you kind of made that up.
Did you ever hear that, Will?
No, I did not hear that. But this James Dean in this painting is standing up in the Porsche, and that's not a good idea.
It's not a good idea. It's not
so
safe.
Maybe that's how
that's
he
might be why
away.
He died. He's driving with his dick in that picture. Okay, Key, what you got?
Okay, so this is more of they're asking for your advice rather than a story.
Ooh, I love to give some chicken head advice.
So, it's about his wardrobe. This guy sends me a picture of Robin Hood. And
bad move, but
it's my buddy, that actor, Cary
and
Elwes.
He says,
yeah, not really, though, huh?
If he was your buddy, you would call him Cary Elwes instead of Cary Elwes, because that's not his name. Anyway, sorry, Cary.
Or you'd have him on the show. I've never heard you talk about
him. You can have him on the show. Do you want to have him on the show? He's great.
Cary Elwes or Cary Elwes?
Carry
on, special carry.
Okay, so he says, I've recently started using tights when I work out, but I have a problem. Where do I hide my penis? Or is it just acceptable to just show it to everybody?
No, it's not acceptable. You put shorts over the tights. That's what every normal man does.
He doesn't have a big D, But he says you could still see the outline and the size. So is it acceptable to wear tights?
Never.
If not, where should I hide it?
Never. No,
well, why don't
dude,
you just hide just it put right up
shorts
your ass.
On. You put tights and you put shorts
hide
on.
Hide it behind shorts, you fucking dummy. Hide it behind cloth. Like
obviously,
100%. He's from Sweden.
Oh,
I don't
then
give
all bets
a,
are
oh,
off.
Oh, that makes sense. Then oh, in Sweden, you should be you working out tights. Naked and just carry some disinfectant in a rag.
Yeah, then everyone goes to their communal homes and cooks for each other. And takes turns washing each other's
tights. All
right,
dude, you're being a little bit of a Swedish
guy. Yeah, whatever. I don't go for these Swedish types. Yeah,
yeah, but
I got a guy. Yeah.
All of a sudden, I become some New York guy who hates Swedes.
Fucking these Swedes.
And you know these fucking Swedes.
All these
Swedes. If it's
fucking
not one thing, it's another with these Swedes.
It's a nutter. One thing, it's a
there's one thing I fucking can't stand. It's a Swede.
It's a fucking Swede. All these fucking Swedes. I'm so New York. Hey, all these
yeah.
fucking Swedes.
Hey, you guys
want to
hear my new character? Yeah, his name is Swede.
So New York. Swede. Everything?
No, his name is Swede Hater Paul.
Yeah, hey, I have fucking a. Hey. Oh, the other day I had a meatball hero, and then I spat it out because it was made by a fucking Swede.
Come on, hey, meatball Swede. Hey. I mean, Swedish
meatballs. Swedish. I like my mom's meatballs with a gravy. Oh,
Swedish hater. Hey. Swedish hater, Paul. Yeah. There's got to be something about Sweden you like.
Yeah, I'll tell you what I like about Sweden.
Girls?
It's shaped like a fucking asshole. Fuck you. Hey.
Well, it actually isn't. It's
yeah,
wow.
It's shaped like a big fucking country.
I feel like you don't know much about Sweden.
Yeah,
what
I know all sorts of stuff about. Go ahead.
Okay.
Right. Ask me anything
right.
about Sweden.
What are the
this
two
guy
countries,
thinks
what are the two countries that sort of, what is Sweden border?
What's the borders the two countries of fucking Norway. Are we talking about fucking what is on the other side of it?
Yeah.
And who gives a fucking shitland?
All right. I just feel like you're. Have you ever been to Sweden?
Yeah, it's fucking midnight, 400 days out of the fucking calendar year, and it's fucking impossible. Oh!
Okay, well, you have to admit that they're a beautiful girl. Did you date a Swedish girl who broke your heart?
I might have had my heart broken.
I knew it.
Oh,
I fucking knew it.
I knew it was something.
Swedish hating Paul.
There has to be something.
Is there any more? Is there any more? Is there any more creep line? That's it? All
that
right.
Dude's.
Thank you, Keely.
Yeah, it's very, very
wow.
simple to solve.
What a dumb question. Hey, I put on when I walk around with my dick, people can see my dick. Where do I hide it?
How should I just tuck it like a fucking camel tail out
yeah,
the back?
These stupid yeah. fucking Swedes.
Just hide it behind cloth, Swedish guy.
Yeah.
Hey, Swedish guy, I got a little
any
news flash.
Any kind of cloth.
I don't know if they have that where you live. They're called shorts.
Yeah. Yeah.
Try that
too
out.
Too cold.
Yeah, why don't you fucking go to IKEA and fucking take a lamp?
Go to IKEA and fuck yourself. All right, carry on.
You became Italian.
Yeah,
it's like actually
yeah.
Italian.
Well, I'm Italian. I'm Italian.
You're not.
Well, you're not.
What are you?
Go, current events.
Okay,
let's move
past the Swedish hating thing and into current events.
Go.
All right.
All right, first current event. R&B star Akon is trying to bring 600 million people in Africa solar power. He's okay. trying to basically light up half the country.
I like him.
How cool is that?
I like him.
Pretty baller. He's building a whole solar electricity academy.
Good
God,
for him.
God
oh,
bless
but hey, media outlets, cover Caitlyn Jenner instead of
yeah,
well, no,
exactly.
Hold on a second. How come, because I've heard this before, people say like no one's covering this, but they're covering that. Why can't, I think what we need to blame here is the media outlets.
100%.
Or
more
for not
importantly,
covering both.
Or more importantly, people
we should
who
cover
are more interested in that than the things that really matter, like this guy.
Yes.
That's
why does it have to be one versus the other?
I agree, but why not cover both? What, do we not have enough airtime?
Well, both is different than bringing it up to say they shouldn't be covering that.
I think the point is that what sells more is Caitlyn Jenner and not people who are making a true difference.
Because Caitlyn Jenner is new and we don't understand it. Akon helping people,
true.
We understand,
yeah.
and it's
That's
just everyday
point.
Shit.
That's a good point.
But well, you can cover both. I'm with Will. Cover
yeah,
both.
Yeah, you can cover whatever you want, but I
but at
I
least
just
give
don't
Akon
see,
attention.
I don't see what saying the Caitlyn Jenner story getting attention. I don't see what's bad about that.
I don't either. I'm just saying that you should cover Akon as much as you're covering
Brian. Why are you Caitlin? Fiddling with your phone?
I don't know. Just you're Akon bored? Makes me think about my phone. I love that idea. That's an ambitious project. 600 million people solar power. Wow,
that's awesome.
Yeah, wow. That's incredible.
Next event, Ev.
This one is pretty much specifically for you, Will.
Okay.
It's gonna stick in line with the dark pot with the dark podcast we're having today. Dusty Rhodes died today.
Yes. Yeah. I just heard about this before I got here. Dusty Rhodes, the American dream, has passed on. pretty young, actually. He was in his 60s. He would have been
69.
He's 69.
Who, which guy is this?
Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream, the son of a plumber. He was sort of in the pro wrestler in the NWA.
Oh,
and,
really?
And you know, early on in the independence, was the hero of Ric Flair. Ric Flair's first gimmick was Ramblin' Ricky Rhodes. He wanted to be Dusty Rhodes' cousin. Mm. That was his first gimmick. And Dusty Rhodes is one of the absolute best talkers ever.
Really?
And I just
got a mouthpiece on
one
him.
One of the most entertaining people of all time. And if you're listening, you don't know who Dusty Rhodes is, go to YouTube and just YouTube Dusty Rhodes promo or Dusty Rhodes interview. The guy was as good a talker as anyone ever in anything, and he had this incredible lisp.
You're about to cry right now, Will.
Don't cry out loud. No, yeah, no. Dusty Rhodes.
What did
he
die from? Do we know?
I don't know.
Being big as shit.
What did he die? Does it say what he died from?
Took a spill.
He fell.
Fell.
Oh, that really breaks my heart.
Took a spill. Jeez, we're not seven. You can tell us how he died.
He fell.
He took a little. He took a little night.
By the way, took a spill.
Night night. He took a little night night.
Why him and not one of these? One of these guys that broke out of prison. Why him?
Yeah, there you go.
Was it icy? What are we talking about here?
I'll tell you a thing about Dusty Rhodes. When I was a kid watching Dusty Rhodes, he, before you start to formulate, and this is why probably I'm so crazy about wrestling, and it is super sad.
Yeah,
and
he's
survived by two. His two sons are wrestlers, and up until very recently, both of them were on the WWE roster.
Oh wow!
Yeah, Gold Dust has been around for a long time. He just kind of came back to do it with his younger brother Cody Rhodes, who is Stardust on the show. And it's super sad. But
you're so look, into WWE.
I'm so fucking into it. And he that's. That it truly is sad that he's passed away. And I'll tell you, when I was a kid, before I could like formulate, oh, this is an actor, this is a wrestler, this is a comedian, this is a rock star, Dusty Rhodes was just Dusty Rhodes. Like he was like, he was such a personality that you would look at him and just be like, oh, it's like John Belushi or David Lee Roth.
He's an entertainer.
He was just an entertainer. He's, yeah. I'm telling you, watch his promos.
I've never heard of him. I'll
the
look him
guy
up now.
Can
Shit.
Talk a blue streak. He was incredible on the mic. Incredible.
Rest in peace, my man. Don't know who you are, but I'm going to Google you.
Do you know who Gold Dust is?
I don't.
I had no idea that was his son.
Gold Dust is his son.
He's one of the most bizarre characters in any kind of
damn,
show,
crazy.
Sport,
crazy.
Anything
I've ever Evan the Beard and Will, you guys should get out together after this, do coffee and talk about WWF.
There you go.
Hey, Evan, let me tell you something. Gold Dust, right? is Dustin, that's Dustin Runnels, right? That's Dusty's son.
Oh, is it Dustin Diamond? Is
that you're thinking of Saved by the Bell.
Screech.
That's Screech.
So
Dustin
now,
Diamond. He did a porno.
I'd rather grow up, I'd rather grow up idolizing wrestlers than, you know, you growing up idolizing
Watch your mouth,
Slater.
Watch your mouth, bro. Watch your mouth. Zach Morris.
When the alarm gives out a warning, and I know I'm something Sornin, and my I'll make it on time. I forget the lyrics, but I'll tell you something. Check this out. Stardust is Cody Rhodes. He's you know what, Evan? He's Goldust's younger half brother.
Hey man,
you
move
two
on.
Should get together after the show.
Stardust.
Okay. Hey man, move on, man. Before I freak
rest
out.
In peace, Dusty Rhodes.
Rest All right. peace. Last current.
Hopefully, Dustin Diamond gets over it. All right, go.
Last current event. The game. Was playing a pickup basketball game, got a little pissed off, punched a dude in the face, sucker punched the shit out of him. Damn. Turns out, guy's an off-duty cop.
Ooh. But does he still get in trouble since he's off-duty?
He's getting sued for $12 million, so yeah.
Wow. Well, the game, the rapper,
the game?
Rapper.
The game's a big kid, too.
Oh, man.
Must have hurt.
$12 million for one sucker punch.
They'll settle out of court.
Why don't we take that $12 million and we'll put it towards Akon's solar power.
There you go.
Or help out Caitlyn Jenner for surgeries. I mean, just you're talking about giving both,
bro. Really?
You're talking about giving both, bro.
You know what?
Why not split it? Brendan
just called you out on that.
Six mil.
You want both, Will.
That is fair. Fair is fair.
Cut off that dick.
You don't like.
Save some
you
trees.
Do
you
not.
You don't cut off the penis. You actually push it in.
No, you don't. You split it like a hot dog and you tuck it in.
That's what he just
is that
said.
True?
Yeah.
You talking
No, he now. Said you just push it in like a mushroom. No, you split it like a hot dog and you make
I didn't know that.
I might be making up. No, but you split it like a hot dog and you tuck it
in. Is this true?
Yes. And they put all the nerves inside.
Holy cow.
I like the way the dick tastes.
So you split it and push it in.
You split it like a hot dog and fold it inside out, and then I'm not sure what you do with the rest.
How painful must that be?
I might
probably pretty painful.
But
I know
I'm a professional. I watch botch all the time.
I know a transsexual who once said that they made a funny little line once and said they lost their virginity twice. Because if you think about it, they did.
Yeah.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah,
because if you think about it, well,
wow, because I remember this hairdresser I knew got the whole operation, and dated this kind of pudgy. Well, on Matt TV,
I know who you're talking about.
And yeah, it doesn't matter. She was dating this guy who was just this dude, and I was always like, "What? How are they having sex?" And he was probably doing that.
Yeah,
or in the butt, Brian. In the butt.
There is the butt.
What? In the butt. Yeah, you guys don't know that tune. You don't know that tune. That YouTube.
Well,
hate.
I feel like.
Yeah, I do.
I feel like just like knowing a couple transsexuals, it's like that's it's. You know, I don't know. I'm not on the Arthur Ashe voting committee, but it's pretty fucking brave.
It is, but is it more brave than the girl playing her last season of basketball and dying?
I don't know that there's such a thing as the brave off. All I'm saying.
No, we're having a brave off right now.
The brave off.
This is the
fighter and the kid.
You make a good point. There is no brave off.
No, there's no brave off.
I think
both of them deserve an award. How about you give out two? How about you give two?
Let's give everybody fucking awards. I think Caitlyn Jenner would be just as struck as anybody by that brave young woman who played basketball through that illness and then passed away at the end of it. And I also think that Caitlyn Jenner would be upset to hear that people or would mention her in the same breath as to say, well, this is braver than that or whatever. I don't know. I kind of feel like this person's past as Bruce Jenner, as an Olympian, as an Olympian, would should tell us something about, you know, the work ethic, the bravery.
Yeah, it's great. It's great. Real quick, only one of them are financially – there's financial profit from it. Only one of them.
Only
one of them has made way more money becoming a woman. Only one of them to make this decision to do this is profiting off of it. So he used to get paid $40,000 to do public speaking. Now that he's a woman, guess what he gets paid?
She.
$140,000.
Yeah.
So only one of them is a financial.
Hey, guess what? Chalk that up for the earning potential of women. There's a tip of the hat to Patricia Arquette.
Who says it's not equal?
Yeah. I'm just saying, you know, the woman is earning more than the man. This is,
that's
we're moving forward. There's progress
by
here.
By the way, that's
you're
a
putting
good
a dark spin on it.
I guess Brendan thinks that women should make more money than men. And I want to say something right now. Yeah. Well, I'm on your side.
Yeah. Women should.
Which side?
I don't know. I waffle back and forth.
Yeah.
I don't really care.
It's interesting, though.
No, I actually.
He's thinking about going to Cafe Stella later with.
I don't think. I do think that there are other examples of bravery in sport.
There's
and in
so
life,
many.
You know,
there's so
that,
many.
That I, but I, Caitlyn.
I'm not saying Caitlyn doesn't deserve
it.
Girl,
right now,
dude. No. I'm not saying she doesn't deserve it.
Here's what's suspect.
I think it's a little bit of a marketing ploy by
ESPN.
Absolutely.
Here's
what's
suspect.
You want ratings? Have Caitlyn Jenner on TV.
Look, I agree.
Yeah.
100%.
That's what's suspect.
The girl that died of cancer. Yeah. She's not going to get ratings.
By the way, for the record, I agree that I don't think that Caitlyn Jenner getting the ESPY award for courage is that appropriate. A lot of people are brave, and she did her thing. But there are a lot of people like Kristen Beck who I would give bravery
more at risk.
Fuck,
more at risk
in every way. I'd give her the ESPY, but I understand.
Although she's not an athlete, though, it usually goes to athletes.
True. Well,
yeah, brother, like Brutus the Barber Beefcake, brother, he deserves one
Hulk's
of those.
Back.
Or how about the British Bulldogs, dude?
Okay.
Or what about Tito
you
Santana,
can't just come
brother?
In like this.
Or Nikolai Volkoff.
Brett the Hitman Hart.
Brett the Hitman Hart, brother.
Okay, but Hulk, you can't just walk in and take the mic. Will do something.
Okay,
Will,
brother.
Will. Get your friend out of here. Hulk, no more Hulk.
Can we please? Come on. But please,
yeah. Hulk, just shut your fucking mouth.
Can you go out, please? Thank you.
All right, brother.
Jesus Christ.
Fine.
Fucking guy
God,
was waiting
God,
outside.
Get rid of that
I think what is
guy.
Suspect is you will never know the true motives of those that are in the positions of power at this network or that studio with regard to why they put someone on TV and what gains they will make from that, because advertisers like Coke, Ford, and Budweiser will pay more for
you're
the
right.
ad space.
For ratings.
Ratings. We will never know the true motives. I think it's a mistake to point the finger at someone, any individual, and say you are more or less brave.
I'm not pointing fingers.
But we're not.
I think they should
both get. We're not on the Arthur Ashe voting committee. So everyone who's saying this is more brave than this, to me, it doesn't make sense.
No, it's all brave. Mm-hmm. I think every soldier should get an award.
I mean,
this is silly.
Right.
But if you're going to give it to one, I think you should do two. It's whatever. Mm. It's ratings. Is that it, Ev?
That's it. That's it for current events.
Yay. Right.
Yay.
Right. Will Sasso, you've been a good guest so far.
Hey, thank you very much.
We got fan questions?
Sorry, yes, I hijacked the show earlier and did 10
minutes. Listen, man, you've been a good guest. As usual, Will Sasso bringing money. Let's wrap up with some fan questions.
Let's do it.
Fan questions, fan questions.
You have such a range, fair and lilting tone. No, it's soothing.
Yeah.
It is soothing.
Let's go to fan questions.
You doing all right over there?
Yeah. Knees are bundled up. Go.
Oh, boy.
And I'm about to piss my pants.
First question comes from JSums44. Of all the sports you guys enjoy doing, which ones are you the worst at?
I'm not bad at any sports.
That's a bold-faced lie.
Bullshit.
Darts and pool.
You're terrible at basketball.
Darts, pool, and basketball are the worst.
I'll tell you what I'm horrible at. Baseball. Sucked at it.
Really?
Sucked at it growing up. Hated it.
I wasn't good at it. I could field, but I was afraid of the ball. Couldn't hit it.
I don't know if you consider a sport, maybe. Ping pong? I'm not good at ping pong. I just never grew up doing it. Mm. Do you consider a sport?
Or
is it a hobby?
No.
It's not a sport.
No, I'm not going to go with sport.
No.
Yeah.
I cannot get a bat on the fucking ball, and there's nothing more frustrating.
Nor can I.
Can you,
I just
Brendan,
swing
you
so
baseball?
Hard,
yeah,
I
played
and
some
I
baseball.
Suck.
I like baseball.
Isn't that frustrating?
Baseball.
So fucking frustrating.
Pretty so frustrating.
You're good at, you're pretty good at all the American sports.
Yeah, I'm an American, so.
If you had dedicated your life to either baseball or basketball, do you think you could have been a D1 athlete in both? Or you don't know? It's a two-hard question.
Not basketball, because I feel like basketball, you got to have height. You know, like I'd have to be a real quick point guard at 6'4".
And that's actually too short to be.
Well, you could, but you got to be like Steve Nash. You have to be so skilled. So basketball, no. Any other sport, I feel like if I dedicated my time to it, I could have went professional.
Did you play baseball?
A little bit. But I played lacrosse instead.
Yeah.
The same seasons, both in the spring.
Wow. I played some lacrosse growing up.
Love lacrosse. Big in Canada, my man.
Yeah,
indoor,
I was playing it as a kid, indoor lacrosse, and it was literally like watching like a puppy follow its brothers or something. It was just a swarm, all the kids just swarming around a ball, going around in a bunch, and then just my little fat ass kind of running around them, just looking for someone to cross check in the next week. So I was so pissed off I had to run.
You're the Happy Gilmore of indoor lacrosse.
I hadn't found football yet. Oh, and then by the time I found football, I was like, I'm not supposed to play soccer and chug around with these kids who are thinner than me. I'm supposed to take those kids and toss them.
All right,
yeah, son.
Here and there.
Okay,
here and
down,
there.
All
right.
Down.
Brendan knows what I'm talking about. When
you found
football, Brendan, isn't that something?
Oh, yeah, the best.
You're like, I'm knocking out my friends and tossing them around.
Concussions for everyone around.
Everybody gets
concussions. Oh, you're 7? Check out this blindside hit.
Yeah.
Boom.
Yeah. Hey,
that's
you're
what
7
I was
years
doing.
Old. Why don't you
bigger,
take this helmet
faster.
To ear hole?
And then you let me play lacrosse. I'm like, yeah, you can check guys. I'm like, and they don't see me coming. No, man, if that's how you want to play it.
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Concussion for everyone.
You know what we found out? We know what
Big
we found
Brown
out?
Just headhunts everyone.
You know what we found out in high school? We figured out, me and a couple of my buddies, there's 2 refs in high school football.
Yeah.
There's like 9 refs
they
in
don't
the
see
NFL.
Shit.
They don't see a fucking
Nothing.
Thing. So you bomb down the field and whoosh, there's a big play. There's 2 fucking refs who are volunteers running after the play. And you just go, you know what? Number 62, you've been pissing
guy.
Me off all fucking game. And just take a fucking run at him and put the top of your helmet into his face mask and knock him the fuck out.
Can't
he
do
won't be a problem for you in the
I
third
agree.
Quarter.
In high school, I did the same thing, Will. And then I carried those crazy tactics over to Division I football.
Yeah.
At playing University of Miami, on Miami, the kid kept talking shit to me the whole game. I decided I was going to cheap shot him.
Yeah.
I did, and I caused our team a very hefty penalty. the only time I got mentioned on NBC that day, what was it? Unnecessary roughness on fucking 43.
You're right.
Real dumbass move. It was so blatant on camera. Everyone's like,
no.
Oh,
you're just you're
that,
that guy.
What did your coach say to you?
He goes, what are you doing? What the fuck are you doing? I went, no, I didn't hear the whistle. And I thought, and he goes, just fucking hit the bench. And then I went, no, you'll see. I don't know why I said this. Speaking of lying, I went, you'll see on camera.
Yeah.
It wasn't a foul, man. It wasn't a penalty.
Blatant crime.
Oh,
crime.
Then we get to film like fucking the following couple of days, and he's just playing it, rewinding it in front of me, looking at me, just disappointed.
No.
Like, you're an idiot.
Christ.
That's so
just
sad.
A bona fide idiot. That was playing University of Miami, so that was fun.
Totally worth it, though.
Not really.
I don't know about that.
Well, I think we lost by like 12 or something. That penalty really hurt
us.
Damn. Really set us back.
You lost the game for them. That sucks.
Nah, not really. Our quarterback, Joel Klatt, did, but I love him. Anyways, carry on.
Next question comes from Maka Flakani.
Maka Flakani.
Maka
do you
Flakani.
Hate followers?
Seriously, why do they have to pick such confusing names? Make it a Flakani. Word that already exists.
At Maka Flakani 99767 _9-7.
Maka Flaka Maka Flocka Flam, whatever. If you guys escaped from prison, how would you evade the authorities? So now you're Shawshanking.
Dress up like a woman.
Yeah, there you go. We're bringing it all together, aren't we?
Bringing it all together.
It all comes full circle.
Change. I get a sex change. I start sucking off all the inmates, and they're like, "We got
to." You'd go back to the prison to suck everyone off?
Yeah.
You're already out. No,
but I want to sell it. I don't want them to think anything fishy. You know what though?
You can get a sex change.
I want to go back in.
Then they have to put you in a female.
You go back in
just to prove to everyone that I'm not the guy that escaped.
But right. You get a sex change, you go back to, now you go to the women's prison, and you're safer, you're probably a little stronger.
And I have my dong?
Yeah.
And you have your dong.
You keep your dong.
Oh, and I'm doing work in there.
Yeah.
I'm just racking up the numbers.
I'm a girl now.
That's a great idea. Tinder prison, and I'm just the hit.
Tinder prison.
Oh, my God. You're just a dude with longer hair.
Just going to town on these inmates. Or a nightmare. Or you're a sex slave, Brian. You're the only one with a dick in the entire prison.
Shaving yourself.
And those girls are a lot bigger than us.
You got to do what you got to do.
Shaving yourself with a sharpened piece of mirror.
Oh.
That you have.
And you just have someone fucking put cornrows in your hair
twice a day.
Oh, boy.
Ugh. Bad idea. Just next question.
So you're escaping prison by having a sex change, then sneaking back in to suck everyone off?
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Because
Brendan needs to come out of the closet right now in case he hasn't already.
No, honestly.
Flawless plan.
No, what I would do is
I don't know why you jumped to sucking a bunch of guys off.
Because I want them to feel like I'm not the guy who escaped, so I'm going back in to suck dick.
I'm going
to
suck everybody's dick. That's my disguise.
Line up, everyone. I'm not the guy that escaped. Bro, it looks just like you.
Nah,
a dong in my mouth. They're never going to see this.
He starts a company called Conjugal Vicky. Who is this Conjugal Vicky? Oh, she's just a gal who shows up and blows everybody.
Sucks everyone every Wednesday. Right. No,
I would do a lot like that guy who broke out of here a couple months ago.
And now he's right here in prison. Just gonna lock him up.
He's got the same tattoos.
No, bro, this is what I'm gonna do. Obviously, the guys that just broke out laid the game plan, and they honey dicked one of the prison guards, which was a female, that obviously gave them the power tools to escape and set the plan, and gave them blueprints. So you put fucking the three of us in there, we're going to find the one female security guard, honey dick her real good over the years. She gives us the power tools and the plan.
Dicking? Man, the way you said honey dick, first of all,
you start
jacking your hand sideways.
But it was your mouth.
Your lower lip bent down in one direction. I'm offended.
Well, when I said honey dick,
I don't even know what honey dick means.
Honey dicking her real good.
Like in, as in,
honey dick.
Oh man, I gotta take a shower. Next question immediately.
Sorry, honey dickin's like
being charming.
Yeah, man, pulling a once over on him. You know what I'm saying?
Being a bit of a cock tease. Your head's going into your shoulders right now.
Cock tease.
Oh God, you're getting all kinds of creepy.
He put less C's in that cock.
Carry on. Next question. That was weird. I've lost myself there.
Yeah.
Lost myself.
Got a lot of hand.
We're all now dumber for that explanation.
I award you no points.
He's not
going to
break us out
soul.
Of prison at all. Terrible idea.
No, you don't want me in prison. I would die first day.
Could have just said no. This one comes from Olson Elena. What's your favorite summer memory from when you were younger?
Summer memory.
Summertime.
Crying with my buddy Phil after losing soccer and football games.
I don't even have one. How about that?
Good summer.
You have zero memories.
I don't have one memory of my
childhood. Are you cutting off of this episode, Brian? Are you kind of out of it?
I don't know, man.
You have no memories.
Not really. I was like a really great memory riding jet skis in New Hampshire. I don't have
any
good memories.
Shitty childhood. For me, I could go on and on. Probably being in college in the summer, and you'd get like a couple weeks off. And me and my buddies, Paul Creighton, Joe Klopfenstein, doesn't matter their names, and my brother, we'd all go to the Boulder Creek and rent fucking big tire tubes and go down the creek. It was
Forget that. Nice. You're a bitch. I know mine.
Hey, Brian, tell us yours.
Oh,
please be a wrestling story.
I know mine. I was with Marty Moore, and I was 17, and we were at the beach. We took his van and went up to a beach
in Connecticut.
Was
it an all-white beach back then?
May as well be. And Marty walks by and he goes, I just walk by what dreams are made of. And I go, what do you mean? He goes, just walk up there. And I walk up and these two girls in bikinis are lying out and they're the hottest things. I'm 17. Mm. Long story short, they go to get an icy cone or whatever. And I go, let's go over and get an icy cone. Let's stand in that line. Next thing you know, we start talking to them. Next thing you know, and I'm talking about 2 hours later, we're both having sex with them in Marty's van, and we had sex with them all weekend long and switched off. And when you're 17 and you meet a couple turbo
sluts.
Yep.
Couple turbo sluts.
And they were older and they were straight up turbo. It was the greatest summer of my life. That was an incredible, I don't know how long it was, 4 days.
You guys were just a couple lounges.
First time I had like sex where I just had sex and kept having sex. Like I just.
Well, you weren't doing missionary and it was kind of boring. You got a little weird with these older girls.
Weird the older girls and
switch. Did your friend look over and go, then, Brian, and my buddy about
goes,
to come.
My buddy goes, she wants to switch off. She likes you. I go, what? He goes, yeah. I go, all right. And then she ends up over here and then I start fooling around. It was the craziest.
Dude, what kind of turbo sluts are on this beach? Like, look at those.
The good kind.
Fucking.
My buddy Marty was really good looking. My buddy was way better.
Let's hook up with him.
My buddy was way better looking than me. He looked like the California kid, super muscular, tan, long hair. And I was kind of the skinny, but you know.
Oh, you were the grateful type.
I was just the personality.
You were the one that were like, I guess he can come.
And I had the rap. I had the rap.
You are charming.
I had the rap.
Always have been.
Yeah. I never had a problem getting girls.
Will, any summer stories?
Well, I was going to say I really enjoyed when my dad would take myself, of course, my mom and my brother and sister camping.
I'm bored.
But,
shithead.
You know.
Fuck you, man.
Well, but Brian took just a nice question and found a way to talk about fucking and talk about switching off.
Good time, though.
The question was.
Good time, though.
Favorite.
Switching off.
The favorite summer memory.
I forgot about
favorite
it.
Childhood summer memory was the question. And Brian Callen told a story and used all sorts of colorful language to describe the acts and the women involved. And
switching off.
And it was switching off. There were snow cones. That was the only thing
and
that had
van.
Me going.
And a dirty this, van.
There was nothing childhood about it.
Nope.
The only thing summer about it was icy cone.
That's true.
So I enjoyed going camping.
And the beach.
Anyway.
And the beach.
You're a good guy.
But that
though.
Was the best.
What else
that
you got to have one more?
I'm not a good guy. That. I'm just saying.
Well,
you know,
you're a bitch.
I'm not a bitch. All
right.
Sounds like a great time.
Let's wrap this up.
If I had a DeLorean, I'd jump back with you.
Damn right. Friend. Damn right. Let's finish this up.
Let's see here.
I had to ruin it all.
No. Please. You kidding me?
All right. We'll do one more. And we are going to go with. That's a weird question.
Yeah, brother. One. Pick one. Yeah, dude.
Okay, here we go. This is for you, Will. Uh-oh. Has Brian ever embarrassed you in public to the point of pretending you're not his friend? And I guess this goes for both of you, really.
Oh, man. You remember, Brian, do you remember when we were at Cantor's? It was you, me,
yes,
Dalia, and a bunch of other people.
That's when you said, let's do a podcast.
That's right. That's when we were like, we've got to do a podcast together. Because we were just hanging out, just clowning around all the time. It was like, I think we need to do a podcast. Ugh. I was trying to tell a story. Okay, if you've ever been to Cantor's on Fairfax in L.A., there's a main entrance, but there's also, imagine a restaurant that has a side entrance that just goes into the middle of the thing. It's usually the doors that are locked in any restaurant that say, enter to the left, use other doors. These doors are wide open, and I forget the story I was telling, but it ended with me going, yeah, it's like someone walking into a thing going, and I run into the middle of the restaurant, like, but I'm just doing it for the visual for everyone outside the restaurant. And Brian is hanging by the opening door and screams out, hey, everybody, I'm Will Sasso. So loud.
And you turned around and came running back out. And I tried to hold the door. And you knocked me into traffic. Like I was like, oh, my God. Like,
so days.
Yeah, I could not. I was like, I'll hold the door. Yeah, good luck. Will literally went, just push it. And I went flying. I was like, I didn't have a
but it was,
shot.
I don't know why it embarrassed me so much.
Well, because they all recognized you.
Right,
and they were
right.
already kind of, they were kind of like comic book nerds. And they were like all into you. And I could see the scuffle. They were like, oh, it's Will Sasso. And that's why
but
I knew,
would, they wouldn't have seen. They wouldn't
you
have
hate
seen
that.
Me.
But they did. And you hate that.
But
so you're like wearing your
right.
hat. And as soon as you walked in, I went, I'm Will Sasso. And they all,
right.
they all went, yay! Like that. And as like, you turned back around and went running back out.
Oh, that was funny.
I did that to my wife when we went to see, what's it called? The scary movie.
Insidious.
Yeah, as she walks in, I go, "Well, I'm Amanda, fuck faces."
Right,
she came running.
It's the best.
Down.
It's the best.
I love doing that.
No, Brian's never embarrassed me. Really, usually I embarrass him. I think.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. No, never.
Not the answer I was expecting.
Never, not once.
Well, you can.
Brian loves putting people
you know,
on the spot.
If he's around fighters, I feel uncomfortable.
Because, you know, I'll ask questions.
He just asks the worst questions where I know what a fighter's thinking. I'm like, God, he wants to get out of here so bad.
Yeah.
Because Brian's like, hey, you know, it's like the fucking Chris Farley Saturday Night Live skit. Hey, remember that time you fought that guy? And everyone's like, yeah, man, yeah. Everyone knows.
Yeah,
that was
that's
awesome.
The only time I'm embarrassed is when he's around other athletes.
Chris Farley's here.
No, he's not.
No, he's not.
So, okay, if that's your barometer for what Brian does is embarrassing, does that make the Tim Tebow, your birthday dinner, the most embarrassing?
No, it wasn't that. It wasn't.
No, it was horrible. All three of us were there.
That was bad. Brian's like, nah.
Hey, man, really? You're trying to relax? You show up to one of your best friend's birthday? Real quick, top five linebackers all time. And he goes, what? Jeez.
No, he liked that question.
I promise you he did it.
He got into it.
No. He told me after the next day, he goes, does Brian always do that? I went, yes, every time with every athlete.
Yeah, but not really.
You do, though. Every athlete.
No, I mean, I think he actually got it. He was like, ooh.
And
he
I
got
don't know. We might have to bring out the Brian Callen, the lyometer again, because it's not. All three of us were here,
and all three of us were awkward, except for you.
And Tim said something to me after the dinner.
Well, he was a little into it. He bit his hand. He went, ooh, that's a good question.
You saying not really to that is also like saying, I'm sort of driving home.
All right, let's wrap this. Let me read an email we got from a fan. We'll do this at the end of the shows from now on. We're getting so many dang emails. I got to give you guys some shout outs. This guy, I'm not going to read his name. I think he wants to remain anonymous. So here's his email to the entire Fire and the Kid team. He puts, team, just want to say thank you all for an amazing podcast that has almost acted as a form of therapy for me. I'm a veteran who suffers from PTSD due to 3 combat tours in the Middle East. Wow. I got out in 2009 and pursued my passion for fighting when I was diagnosed with early symptoms of Parkinson's at the age of 30. That put me in a dark, dark place. And one of my coaches told me about the Fighter and the Kid podcast. He said it was a fighter and a comedian who talked about insane topics and had some good viewpoints. That's debatable. Since the first podcast I listened to where Brendan talks about responding to his buddy's house to help him with his purple gecko. That's the story where my buddy broke his penis. I've been hooked. I know you guys get this a lot, but I just wanted to say again, thank you for the service you guys provide, which is crazy because he's the one who we should be thanking. It goes a long way. And even if you don't realize it yet, you guys have had a positive impact on both my outlook regarding my recent diagnosis, but also how I look at life in general. Sincerely, thanks from a veteran.
Wow.
Yeah, man, that was awesome. That was very moving. I sent him back an email thanking him for that. That's very inspiring.
Pretty cool. Yeah, so man. We'll do this at the end of every show. We get so many of these.
Yeah, I want to piggyback a nonprofit. Also, Daniel Martinez, who runs something called Just Cool Me. And Just Cool Me raises awareness about head injury and stuff. When somebody has a head injury, you should try to cool their head, and they have all the information on their website, and they do all this work and educate schools and stuff about how actually when you get a head injury, cooling the brain is really, really important because it can save somebody from life-threatening illnesses. So justcoolme.com. There it is. I'll be in San Francisco. At the Punchline, June 25th, 26th, 27th. Come see me. It's going to be some fun. Will, you want
to
pitch something?
You got anything, Will?
Listen 10 to Brian,
minute podcast?
Yeah, listen to Brian's other podcast, 10-minute podcast.
10-minute podcast and buy it live because it's fun. It's one of the fun. That's probably
that was a fun show.
I think that was our best show.
It was great, man. It's number one on iTunes. You can get it on iTunes, the 10-minute podcast live. Get it on iTunes now. Go to tfatk.com. We still have some merchandise left. I know we have the sex, drugs, and podcasting shirt. Not many left. We do have some. Other than that, we're almost sold out. That's it. Get everything you need for the Fire and the Kid at tfatk.com.
Including
videos,
tour dates.
YouTube, Brian's tour dates, although they're off sometimes. We got everything you ever need on there. Will, the man Sasso, thanks for coming on. This is the Fire and the Kid. We're out.